What is up, Fire and the Kid fam? What a weekend. Ev, you look like you have a little bit of UFC 202 hangover, my man. I'm not going to lie to you.
Oh, I've got the 202 flu real bad.
Yeah, the 202 flu. The 20 flu.
You should not, takes a couple days to recover from that one.
You shouldn't have a flu. There should be no sadness. I think it's the, and I tweeted this out, I think it's the best fight in the UFC in, I can't remember, man. For me, it was a game changer. I think it was not only the most important fight in UFC history, but it delivered. Name the last fight of that magnitude that delivered. Floyd Mayweather, Manny Pacquiao? Terrible. Granted, Floyd did a great job, but it was a terrible fight. Think how much hype was around this fight. And not, you couldn't write this. You know what I'm saying? You literally, you couldn't write how good this fight was. And I gotta be honest, man. When Conor was, they made him walk out first, obviously. He lost the last one, and it's not even his division, and Nate's ranked higher, so that's why he walks out first. But when he was walking out, I knew it was gonna be a good night because how serious he was. If you remember the first fight, me and Cal were watching it together at Frank Grillo's house. The first fight with Nate Diaz, when he walked out and he's high-fiving like he's in the club, I looked at Bryan and went, oh no, he doesn't realize what kind of animal he's dealing with. I went, I don't think this can be good. And Bryan goes, why do you say that? I went, he's not focused, he's not taking it serious. He thinks it's just another walk in the park. And you're fighting, not only are you fighting one of the dogs of the UFC, but he's also experienced, way bigger, better boxer, and probably the toughest guy to ever walk through the octagon. As far as straight toughness, Nick Diaz, Nate Diaz, both of those guys are first team, all tough, co-captains. I'd love to hear an argument say different. So when Conor in that first fight didn't take it as serious, I knew he was in trouble. This one, there was no games. You could tell he was nervous, which I love. He was dead serious, mouthpiece in, ready to go. But when he started doing well in that first round, then he started to get a little comfortable. Like, oh no, what are you doing, man? He has to deliver those antics and that entertainment value. I get, you got to win this. You lose this fight. That's two in a row. It's over, bro. It's over as far as there's no more Mystic Mac. Now you're just Conor McGregor, and we can't sell that. It's a tough sell. You lose two in a row. It's a tough sell. The Mystic is gone. So first round, two knockdowns. You could have it a 10-8.
Second round was
two. Second round, two knockdowns. First round, one knockdown.
Yeah, first round, one knockdown. So,
before I give my critique of this fight, remember, and there's so much nasty hate out there on the internet, it's okay to be a critical thinker and critique the fight. It doesn't mean you're a troll. It doesn't mean you hate one guy more. If you take your bias out of the fight and you just look at the fight, and I see the Diaz fans posting pictures when Conor turned his back and ran in the fifth round. Well, Conor fans can post three different times when Nate was sat on his ass from punches to the face. So you can't take one aspect of the fight and say, oh, he won because of this. By the fifth round, he was running. No, by the fifth round, he had the fight won, and he's just trying to survive. So first round, obviously, Conor 10-9. Second round, you could argue a 10-8, 10-9. Well, let's just go 10-9 for Conor. So you have first two rounds for Conor. Third round, you have a 10-9 for Nate. By that third round, I was like, oh, shit, here we go again, maybe. And he looked gassed. He looked tired. That's when I was like, dude, you spent six figures on the camp, most expensive camp of all time. You're tired after 8 minutes of fight? Like, he was tired, exhausted. Granted, he's getting kicked in the face, punched in the face, all that. So that's going to hurt your cardio, which you can't duplicate in training camp. So that third round, I was like, damn, here we go. And people thought that was going to happen. I think Nate Diaz's camp thought, first two rounds, Conor's going to tee off. He's going to get going. He's going to light him up. And as he gets going, you just got to, they're like a tidal wave, man. I don't know if anyone else in the world can fight like Nate Diaz does. He's like the Terminator. He just keeps, and finally, like, God, dog, what? I've tried everything. I've done everything. He just keeps coming forward. And he just finally wilt, and he wins the fight. That's how tough those guys are. So that third round, I was like, man, we're in a little bit of trouble. Fourth round, the old Mystic Matt came, dug deep. He dug deep, but you could tell he's in trouble. We started to get his flow back. Nate, all those leg kicks started to catch up with him, you could tell. And then obviously in the fifth round, so So you have first two rounds, Conor, easy. There's no, that's not even a question. If you don't think Conor won the first round, you should never watch the sport again, and you should probably just go watch, I don't know, WWE, where you can predict the winners. So first two rounds, Conor all day. Third round, you have Nate. There's no argument there. 10-9 round. Fourth round, Conor. Again, that's a pretty easy one. Fourth round, Conor. It's very clear to me. There's no controversy here.
That's what I thought, too.
There's literally no controversy.
I thought the exact same thing. First two, clearly to Conor. Fourth to Conor. Third and fifth to Nate. I've seen people arguing, lots of people, including fighters, like UFC fighters on Twitter.
Legit fighters?
Yeah. Arguing that Nate won the second round.
Oh.
I thought that was probably the clearest one. Because he controlled like the last 90 seconds.
And he dropped him twice.
Yeah, it's like, this isn't Pride where you score it based on like the last minute of a fight.
No, it's not the overall sum of the fight. It's round by round. So it's very clear 3-2. I didn't even think it was an argument. So when I saw Flack on social media, I'm like, oh no, don't let your favoritism and your love for the Diaz brothers, who I love too, man. I'm so happy. $2 million, thank God, man. That guy deserves it. His star's only getting bigger. You could argue that Conor won that fight, but Nate Diaz won the war. You know what I'm saying? And as far as war, the popularity war. Because throwing the middle finger, this straight battle, and then with Conor, like, oh, man, that was tough. Like, in that third round, I remember thinking, but not even the third round. I remember in the first round, when they're in the clinch, how big Nate Diaz is, I remember thinking to myself, God, what the fuck are they doing? Let's go pros and cons here. Granted, it's worked out. It's been great for Nate Diaz. This is the fight, and this is the magnitude of a rivalry that he's always needed in his career. And he's never been bigger. He's top five most famous guys in the UFC easily now. Easily, if not top three. The question is the pros and cons of having Conor, your most famous man by far, your most famous fighter by far, fight a guy who's, what was Nate, fifth or seventh in the 170?
I think it was seventh.
Okay. Having him, the pros and cons of him fight Nate Diaz. Like, if you look at it, it's the blueprint to how to ruin your biggest star. Granted, it's made another star in Nate Diaz, but to have a true 145er, some will argue 55er, to have a true 145er fight a 170er who's really a true 155er, but the pros and cons are crazy. It's paid off, but that third fight, I don't know if I want to see it. If you're a Conor fan, I don't know if you want to see that. I don't know if you want to see that. And Dana White made the comment, I'm over this. I'm over this whole Nate Diaz Conor thing. I want to move on. Conor's next fight, and these are the words from the bald horse's mouth there. The next fight is Jose Aldo. Get the fuck out of it. No one wants to see it. Unless you're in his camp, unless you're Brazilian, no one's trying to see a Jose Aldo Conor rematch. I'm not. That does nothing for me. Literally nothing. Nothing. That pisses me off. That fight. And it's not nothing as Jose. He's a great champion. He probably deserves it.
It makes you angry.
It does nothing for me. It does nothing for Conor either. And then he said, so it's either he defends his belt at 145 or vacates it, which I think he should do, or he fights Eddie Alvarez at 155. It's a tough go, too, because that motherfucker can wrestle. That wrestling scares me. So that's why I was telling Bryan on our last show when we were breaking this fight down and with Rogan that for Conor McGregor, it gets a lot tougher from here on out. You know what I'm saying? Like, you're Conor McGregor, there's no easy fights. It's literally like, all right, Nate Diaz, who's enormous, he's way bigger than you, and you had a fucking war, man. That first fight you lost, we can do that trilogy again at 155, which Nate is better at. He's a natural 155er. He's better at 155 than he is 70. So I don't know how that goes down. So it's either trilogy, Eddie Alvarez, Jose Aldo, or you fight one of the other monsters in the top five at 55. It's not fun. It's not. And granted, that as champion, that's how it should be. But you look at it, and I don't know if he's favored in any of those fights besides Jose Aldo. Like, if you're his manager, you're kind of like, the fuck do we do? I'll tell you what you do. I'll tell you exactly what you do and what he's going to do.
All right, let's see if this plan is the same one.
You fight Floyd Mayweather for $30 million and keep the rest of the UFC on ice because you're the biggest star. Get your money. Because the route the UFC is going to have you go, it's going to be fucking rocky, man. It's going to be tough. There's a lot of tough matchups. I don't know what happens. Right now, you're Mystic Mac. You just beat Nate Diaz. Huge rematch. Hopefully, it's the biggest pay-per-view of all time. I'm sure it's going to be up there, top five, easy. His other three fights are. Use that. And from what I hear from inside sources is the only reason Floyd and Conor didn't fight before, they had a venue. The teams agreed to it. I heard everything was in agreement. Money issue between Conor and Floyd, which seems to happen with Floyd a lot. Floyd thinks he deserves all the money, which is a legit argument. And then Conor thinks he deserves all the money. So they just need to come to agreement on the money. Grant, it's a circus. It's kind of, you know, it's crazy. Even think about it. You're fighting probably the best boxer of all time. You're telling me everyone in this room wouldn't pay to watch that? You're telling me you wouldn't rather watch Conor McGregor versus Floyd Mayweather than Conor versus Jose Aldo 2? What?
There's no combat sports event I would buy faster than that.
You and probably... And
everyone.
Everyone.
And everyone. The entire United States plus Ireland.
It might break Manny Pacquiao, Floyd Mayweather.
I guarantee you it does.
And you can charge the same amount.
I guarantee you it does.
Also tell you this. I think it's a huge opportunity for the UFC because you're never going to have another Conor McGregor. A guy of his stature, with his swagger, with his presence that can cross over and fight arguably the best pound-for-pound boxer of all time in a freak match. Floyd Mayweather, he's at the age where he can do it right now, you know. He's not in his prime, but he's damn good. Conor McGregor, huge star. You have this one opportunity. Why not make it happen? And obviously Dana's into money. Obviously he's into money and making ratings. You got CM Punk fighting in a couple weeks. You think, and I love CM Punk. I think the courage it's taking of what he's doing is nuts. It's insane if you think about it. Is he out of his league? Probably. It's going to sell, though. They've done it before. If you now have Brock Lesnar go from WWE to here, they're obviously in it for the money, for the big names, the big tickets. This is your golden ticket. There's nothing bigger. I know people are like, oh, it's ridiculous, though. He can't beat Floyd. Blah, blah, blah. I don't give a fuck about all that. I want to see our best guy go against their best guy and make some money. Because what's it good for? The fighters. Conor will make so much money if he does that. Name another guy who could do it. Name another fighter ever in the UFC who could fight one of the pound-for-pound greatest, if not the greatest, at that weight, and we would actually pay to see it. Usually it's just a shit show. It'd just be a circus. Like, I'm not paying for that. Like if you had, remember when Junior Dos Santos was the champ? If you had Junior Dos Santos, like, hey Junior versus Vladimir Klitschko. Huh? I'm not watching that. I don't want to see that. Floyd Mayweather versus Conor? I don't know, man. It's kind of cool. Get your money. So to me, that UFC, to put UFC 202 in a package, gift wrap pack, it was, to me, the best UFC card in a long, long time. Even the undercards were dope. The Dirty Bird said, main card? What? Went off on that fool. Off. They should stop that fight early.
Yeah, yeah. They let
definitely stop that fight early.
You see the picture that he posted? That
no.
Salvo Hamasi posted afterwards?
No.
Dude, that cut is, you can basically see his brain.
Really?
Bad.
They should have stopped that fight early. His corner should have probably stopped that fight early. Dirty Bird's been, he got sidelined for a little bit for those tainted supplements and was just, it made his blood boil, and then he unleashed a fury on that poor, poor, handsome feller, though. Handsome, handsome feller. But he got murked.
Yeah.
Super murked.
Pretty good.
Second fight wasn't bad, a good fight, but then Cowboy looked fucking.
Oh, Mike Perry against the
yeah.
Young Gulem or whatever. Why is that guy cutting to 170? He's like 6'4".
How's he make it?
He's Asian Rumble Johnson.
For reals. For reals. How's he make it?
No idea. He's probably killing himself to get to that weight.
Can we change his name to Godzilla? hashtag no races. And then Cowboy versus Story. Most analysts had Story winning because he's a bigger guy. 170 is they think it's tough for Cowboy. Cowboy lit that fool up like a Christmas tree and then said, oh, you're a grappler? Check this out. Took him down. Then threw a Mortal Kombat five-piece combo to the face. To the fucking face. That kick to the face stopped him. Then gets on the mic. Remember, Cowboy's already beat Eddie Alvarez at 155. And I agree with Cowboy. That should be his next fight. Cowboy's never been world champion in the UFC. He's already beat this guy. And remember, he didn't beat him. He whooped his ass. It wasn't like, ah, it's close. No. He bully beat down his ass like it was on MTV. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. He beat the shit out of him. So he's going, oh, yeah, let me fight. I'll go back to 155, get the belt, and I'll go back to 70. And remember, his contract's up with the UFC. So this is negotiating power. I bet you, knowing Cowboy, he's going to go, let me fight at 155, Eddie Alvarez, get this belt right quick, real proper. And then I'll go from there and back. I'm down to go back to 170. Because remember, Dana goes, I prefer him to stay at 170. But when you're as hot as Donald Cerrone, you have all this stuff going on, you're going to have some negotiating power. And the negotiating power is, I've already beat the champ. This is probably my best shot to be champ by far. You look at 170, the top five, they're tough match. Like Wonderboy for Cowboys, tough. Woodley for Cowboys, tough. He's already murked Eddie Alvarez. And what's the one thing Cowboy doesn't have on his resume? UFC champ. I think they owe it to him. Now, obviously, the UFC doesn't give a shit about owing anyone anything. The brass doesn't. But for Cowboy, and he's close with Dana, that should be the only fight he's concerned about. Get that belt and then go to 70. Just dip out, vacate, and then go to 50, then go to 70.
Since you're just killing it in the Mystic Brown game right now, what do you think of this roadmap? So Cowboy gets the title shot against Alvarez. Now, assuming he beats him, we'll do Cowboy Alvarez. Conor goes off and fights Floyd. Get that fight out of the way. Comes back down, takes on Nate at 155. If he beats him, title shot against Cowboy.
Nah, Nate, so that I love what you're thinking. I think we skip one step. I think if Cowboy's the title holder at 55, he goes, fights Floyd, comes back, fights Cowboy at 155.
He gets the title shot right off. Because I was only doing Nate 3 there to justify a title shot at 155.
No.
Which I don't think Conor needs in the first place. Which is kind of a second question for you. If Conor vacates the 45 belt, he has an instant title shot the second he decides to go back to 45.
Or, 100%.
Or anywhere, right?
Well, Dana said one of his goals one of his options is 45, defend the belt. 55, he fights for the belt right away. So think about Conor Diaz 3. Think about the buildup down the road when he's the champ at 55. Now you're fighting for a legit belt. Because that 70 was nothing.
And he never lost the belt at 45, so you can kind of pitch the two-division champ thing.
And the trilogy is so much bigger because now you have a world championship right on the line.
Yeah.
Boom. There you go, Joseph. There you go. You're welcome. But I don't – so you do the Cowboy – Eddie Alvarez, 155 fight. Conor does thing with Floyd. It's huge. Conor's name's never been bigger. Cowboys world champ. Conor comes back. Then you have the 155 mega fight with Cowboy.
And then he wins that. Nate gets the first shot. And you have Conor, Nate, 3 for the title.
True. Or that's a tough fight for Conor against Cowboy.
Oh, it sure is. It's predicated on
If he loses that, Nate says he's not fighting again unless it's against Conor. But I bet you'll fight again if it's for 155 against Cowboy because he's already beat Cowboy. Remember that.
Yeah. Put it on him real good.
I'm not mad at that plan, man.
I'm not either.
So, yeah, Cowboy do his thing. Absolutely demonstrative story. And then in the co-main event, which we said, if Glover can get through that first round, which it's such a big if, it's like, Jesus Christ, man. He threw that uppercut from Mars that landed directly on Glover's face. Did you see his tooth fly off?
Yeah.
His tooth
went straight into the air.
It was nuts, man. And was it 14 or 17 seconds?
13.
My thing is with Glover, though, and that's his Tyson rolling style. It's a tough go against Rumble. And Rumble's like, hold up. You're just going to come like that? Gadoosh! I was like, oh, fuck. And I'm so happy for Anthony Rumble Johnson. He's such a beast. He deserved it, blah, blah. Him DC rematch. It's fun. It's a fun one to think about because remember, Johnson rocked DC in that first round, sat him on his ass, which no one's really done by a punch. So that's a fun one to watch. But then he broke him, in the second or third round, choked him out, rear naked choke.
Finished him, I think it was like the last 30 seconds of the second round.
Yeah. So, I mean, you can sell that just because Anthony Johnson's murking fools. The better matchup would have been Glover versus DC because we haven't seen that yet. You can sell that. But for Glover, it's tough, man. He's 37, 38, 37.
Yeah, he's up there.
That's a tough one, man.
Been in the game for a minute.
Yeah, but Rumble looked freaking amazing.
You can't deny Rumble's shot at this point.
Well, he's the hardest hitter in the UFC of all time.
Of all time?
All time. Glover's never been put out. Not only did he put him out, he did it in 13 seconds. And he had that full grapple in the ref. He double leg Big Dan's ass. Dan had to sprawl on him.
Yeah.
Watch the footage.
Oh, no, I saw it. Yeah, it was bad.
It was bad, man.
Like, we've seen that happen a couple times. That was the worst example of that. Because it was way too far after, you know, it had happened for him to still be that dazed. Like, that was a full, almost a minute after the fight had been broken up.
Yeah, you went straight grappling mode. It's tough, man.
Still,
this is what's heartbreaking. The people I was watching with this, because they were all shouting, blah, blah, like, oh, my God, blah, blah. I'm like, this is the thing. As a fighter, you think about Glover. We've been there where you knock out real quick. For Anthony Johnson, the best, right? Didn't get touched. You get your paycheck. You're like, hell yeah, no head trauma. This is the best, man. I'm fighting for the title. Life doesn't get any better. But for Glover, remember, he had a 12-week camp. He had a nutritionist, his diet, 3-a-days, 2-a-days, track workouts, family, training partners, everything that went into it, and you got murked in 14 seconds. There's nothing worse. It's literally the worst case scenario. When someone, when your mental coach, when your coach would go, what's the worst that can happen to you? That would be it, sir. That was it. Because you don't even get a chance to compete. All your hard work, the cutting, and it's a massive cut for him too, man. He's a big dude. When me and him were training together, he's about 240. And fuck, big dude, man. So it's a beast for him to get down. So you're talking about cutting that weight, all that stuff. You didn't even get an opportunity to compete, my man. You might as well roll your ankle walking in the cage. He didn't throw one punt, nothing. 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 You just ate an uppercut. It sucks, man. There's nothing worse. Stylistically, though, him versus Rumble's a tough matchup for him as far as him with that boxing style, and he has to get in close because you're going to eat a shot. That uppercut just happened to be the shot. Brutal, man.
Super brutal. Man, I haven't seen a knockout that bad in a while.
No, and then John, right? And then both, this is funny, DC and Anthony Rumble are both like, John, you got to wait and get in line. I guarantee you, if John comes back, they give him the shot. Sorry, fellas. It's not up to you. And what's weird to me is whenever they show DC on camera, he gets booed. For what?
I have no idea.
It's the Tim Sylvia effect.
Yeah, that was a classy move by AJ in the cage in his post-fight interview.
Yeah, it was.
Telling the crowd not to boo DC, to respect the guy. I don't get it. He's the best.
You know what that doesn't do? Sell fights.
No, it doesn't. Not at all. Anyway,
yeah, let's do it soon, brother. Love you. Hey, man, I'm not trying to see that. No. How about you say, I'm going to knock your ass out just like I knocked Glover out. You're a great fighter. Don't boo that guy, but I'm going to knock your head off and your tooth out just like I did Glover. See you in 3 months. I'm out. Throw the mic down. Rumble these nuts in your mouth. You know what I'm saying? Boom. Like when there's that much reason, yeah. It's tough. Because for DC, if you remember the Tim Sylvia effect, granted, he tested positive for PEDs, but he did also, everything
Tim
in
Sylvia was like the goofiest guy you've ever seen in your life. But like, he's just his body was just like too big for itself.
No, but remember Tim Sylvia? He was like, what can I do to get people to love me? He would get on the mic and be like, I want to thank the troops, kids with cancer, just like everything in the world, and just booed, booed, booed. Bryan Cowan, ladies and gentlemen, about an hour and a half late. What's up, man?
Sometimes you just get stuck.
Yeah.
Sometimes you just get
What's
stuck.
What's up, man?
Well, I've been in the car for 2 hours, but I'm good, and I'm glad to be here.
Nice. Ben should be. We got Ben Henderson on the show today.
I'm excited.
Big Ben.
I'm excited. Sorry to be late, everybody.
Did you bring my fucking cash? Is that I'm assuming you're late because you're at the bank counting my cash.
I was, dude.
You have it in a duffel bag in the car?
I do. I know you wanted cash.
The juice is running.
You said I want cash and not a check. So I had to go and I kept counting it because I don't trust my banker.
Mm.
So that's why I'm late.
That makes sense.
You know what I mean? And then I was counting it again because I know if I'm a dollar short, you're going to take a hand in my face.
The juice is running, my man. Dude, speaking of that, not to change the subject and for sure give me my fucking money, but because I call it the T. But the thing is I was watching. Yeah, to T.
I'm glad I jumped on board with that.
I can't wait to get into this. How come you're all
red? We just went over it. Because me and Ev have been breaking this fight down, man.
You're all excited.
Yeah, yeah. But I watched this thing on Viceland. It's the sickest documentary I've ever seen. They follow a guy who's a debt collector in England, and he's he's a rough dude.
He's
and
a rough guy.
He owns a gym.
Uh-huh. And a boxing weightlifting
gym, and he's just like this rough dude in Liverpool. I've never seen it. I saw on Saturday. I was like, holy shit. He finds out, like, he's just collecting people's debt. This is my thing, though. Why not just call the cops? Like, can you still do that these days? If he came and saw me, I'm like, okay, I'm just calling the cops. Like,
yeah. Well, they have.
I'm have you arrested.
I know that they have companies hire private contractors to go out and get debt. But
like a repo guy?
Yeah, but you're not supposed to show up with a giant dude.
Dude, they show up because homeboy owed this other dude money, so they hired him. That's right. Right. He's like a consultant, so they hired him. He goes to his work, and he goes, hey, can we talk to you real quick? And the guy's like, and you know, he works at fucking like IKEA or some shit. He's in the blue shirt, yellow patch. He walks out, and he's all, do you know who I am? He's like, yeah, I do. He goes, now listen, you're going to have the money by tomorrow. Or you see those two guys standing over there? And it's two fucking crazy big dudes with leather coats on. He goes, they're going to come talk to you. And they walk up and he goes, no, I don't want, and he goes, what? I'll have the money tomorrow. He goes, yeah, you will. And he shakes his hand. And the dudes that he has roughing them up, that they go into those stories of those enforcers.
Wait,
the one guy has slashes all over his neck, face.
Yeah.
And he was traumatized.
He cut himself, right?
Traumatized as a kid. He was molested, blah, blah, blah. Hates himself, so he cut himself.
Yeah.
So they're like sparring. Like, they're like training to be enforcers.
Yeah.
They
have kind of weird boxing training.
Yeah, it's very weird. But at least they're getting the cardio and kind of so they don't gas out when they're fucking people up on the streets.
Yep.
And the guy, he's like, I can't spar today. He's like, why? He's like, I cut myself on my back last night, and I think it's going to open up. He goes, let me fucking see. And he turns around, and it's weird because this community of just royal fuck-ups. The roughest dude you've ever seen, but there's a human character to him because like the head guy who's the lead enforcer, who's a legend, he turns around and goes, if you do that again, I'm going to ban you. You know I love you, but if you do that again, I'm going to ban you. So that guy goes and gets help, like legit medical help. And he's been in some shit, man, in and out. They do tons of drugs.
Well, he's a destroyed human being. And you see the guy like that who might be a tough guy, but he was destroyed as a child.
He's crying out for help.
Exactly.
That's what's going on.
When you cut yourself, you know, and that's very common for sexual abuse victims. How about when he talked about the first time he saw a guy, a debt collector.
Oh, yeah. Listen to this.
Guy was laying on his money. I'll set it up for you. Guy's laying on his money. And he goes, he's a young.
This is the main enforcer. Two guys took him under his wing.
Right.
And so he could learn how to get this business.
It's like his apprentice. This is his first day as an apprentice. And he comes into the guy. Guy's the local thug. And the other guy's a thug. And he goes, where's my money? He goes, I don't have it.
No. But the main guy goes upstairs. He goes, go check up, see if they have money upstairs. He says he goes upstairs to find the money. He's like, what the fuck? And he hears something. He's like, hey, the money's not up. And he comes down. And the two enforcers, they're holding the guy down. The one's fucking the other guy in the ass.
Right in the
but
old
they're
rump.
Taking pictures.
Taking pictures.
And the enforcer that the main character in the show is like, what the fuck? Hey, man.
Yeah.
This isn't part of the gig. Yep. You're like, yeah, it is.
Oh, it is.
It is.
You're getting your ass fucked because you don't have
they
money.
They take pictures, and they said, we're going to send this to your daughter, her school, wherever you work. And it says, pay up by this time next week. The guy obviously paid up. Because
I think he ended up.
He committed suicide 2 weeks later because he couldn't live with himself.
It's a tough one.
What kind of enforcer? That's some next level enforcer shit. Yeah,
it's also clearly an excuse to fuck a guy. Like that's simply a gay man who's pretending not to be gay. Like there's no way
I'm. Let's
be
fuck
like,
him up, man.
All right, you have my money. That's it. I'm getting my dick hard. And here, all right, that nothing gets me more hard. But I'm not gay than somebody who doesn't have my boss's money.
I am not gay. How much do you owe you? $13.
Well, that
$13. What the fuck?
I have it upstairs. I don't see it.
I don't see it. Dude, I told you the money.
I say,
I'm going to give you double. I don't fuck. No, it's the principle.
You're a liar.
It's the principle.
Think about that.
We would get back in the car and be like, okay, I think Donnie's just straight up gay. I don't think he cares about the money.
Of course he is.
And then you find out he's a trust fund baby.
He doesn't.
He's just fucking guys.
I did the correlation. The one thing that makes me hard. You don't have my boss's money. So I'm going to bend you over, you giant man from England who doesn't eat well and probably has a bunch of poo crammed up. And I'm going to.
Right up the old tea kettle.
Unbelievable.
Right up the old black carcass tea kettle.
Gee whiz.
Oh, gee whiz.
That's actually the documentary is actually called Debt Collector. So if anyone actually wants to see that,
game changer. Awesome.
Go see it.
It's game bad. Changer.
I couldn't take my eyes off the screen. In the story, but the head debt guy, like you said, there's the reason why it's so cool is because they don't paint them in this weird thug light. Like the main guy, even after he's driving, he goes, like, everyone comes, tells me their problems. I fix problems. What about my problems? He goes, I have kids, and like, I don't show you guys this, but you know, they put my hair in braids, and I play with them every morning. I do my thing, but I have to be this rough guy all the time, and this hair to everyone else. He goes, I have problems, man. I take all these medications. I have anxiety. I can't sleep.
He has cancer,
I think. He goes, I have throat cancer. And he also has a liver problem. He goes, I have all these problems. I have no one to talk to. It's fucking miserable. Yeah. I was like, damn.
Depressed James Thompsons.
You know better than anybody. Really, you've been around real tough guys. It doesn't mean you're less sensitive or you don't have the same needs to be loved and talked to, and right? I mean, in a way.
No, zero. That's where
it might be even more.
It's even more so because then, whenever you see a big tough guy, whether it's armor from lifting in the gym and taking steroids, and you know they're these big tough guys,
armor, right?
It's an armor. Yeah. It's almost a defense mechanism where they're, I'm tough, man. Don't even think. Yes. Don't even think I cry. Don't even think I can. You can hurt my feelings.
Right.
It's like, well, they've usually done a lot those of guys. Those
studies. Yeah.
Those guys need some sort of outlet, man. You know what I'm saying?
Well,
but also, we were talking about this the other day. Like, being a meathead and being that gym bro isn't cool anymore. Like, being that frat boy, you know what's cool? Being smart, being knowledgeable.
Creative.
You know what I'm saying? Being creative. Like, that's what women are attracted to. Women are attracted. You can't be attracted to a dumb jock anymore. Because there's no longevity in it. I mean, you can fuck them. That might be cool to hook up with him, but you don't want to marry that guy. You don't want to live a life with that guy.
Well, that's
and guys are realizing that too.
Well, that's the realization of everything. If you want to continue on this life, so as an athlete, you might be 32 and your career's over. Very common, right? That might be old for an athlete in some sports. And now you got another 60 years, maybe 50 years to come up with something. And that's where being creative, that's where having a flexible mind, that's where trying to learn something new that requires a different kind of muscle. That's where it all comes.
But plus, also, if anyone's ever been around a guy who has that meathead mentality, it's exhausting, man. You always ask me why I'm not hanging out with other athletes, fighters.
Because it's one-dimensional, isn't it? A lot of times.
Everywhere you have to prove how tough you are. We're in Nordstrom's. Why are you acting tough in here? Why are you eyeballing everyone? We're in the women's section at Nordstrom's. Why are you talking shit to people? What's wrong with you?
Sometimes that's just low self-esteem, too.
100%.
Yeah.
And most tough guys don't talk like
that. Why is that? Why do you think a lot of...
insecurities?
Yeah.
Isn't it
and
weird?
That's what drives them into it.
Isn't it weird?
I know a lot of actors, though. I mean, my experience with actors is a lot of drug use, a lot of booze, and a lot of insecurity.
It's insecurity, but they also have a lot of problems, and they also pretend to be someone else as a career. But with actors, I can hang out with actors, comedians, because most of the time they don't.
They're well rounded,
but they're also. It's not this aggro, testosterone filled. Like,
yeah, you can't stand.
What do you want to compete? Who drinks coffee? What the fuck's wrong with you?
Yeah.
What do you want to see? Orders their meal faster? Like, giving them the competition.
Yeah.
That's exhausting.
Yeah. Well,
but
even
it's also
like,
all they know. They can't contribute with
the. But even in jail, like, you think jail, you got to be a tough guy. I was talking to Stevie, who spent 5 years in jail in Fort Dixon. He said, even the violence, like, would always have to be sanctioned. And because we knew if there was going to be violence, if there was a child molester who was going to get fucked up, or if there was a gang issue, or something had to be resolved, we all knew we were going to be in lockdown for 2, 3, 4 days.
Yeah, you're paying for it.
And so you're paying for it. So everybody was like, fuck, last resort. Even in jail with all those badasses, even in jail,
there's
got to be a process. And also, let's not. Is there any way around this? And also being good with your fists or all that stuff didn't matter. Even there, it was kind of irrelevant. What was more relevant? How many good friends do you have? How many people do you get along with?
It's network. Yeah, it's like
you're spending time in a shitty situation. You better hang out, have a laugh.
Well, even yesterday when I was running, there's these two guys. They're causing up a storm, and I was texting my brother, and I stopped listening to my music just because it was kind of a ruckus over there, and they're in the way of the path. They're being just knuckleheads, and I told him, he goes, what'd you do? I went, I just went around. Like, I'm not going to, what am I going to do? Like, what am I going to stop and fight? Can I beat him up? 100%. What's he going to do?
Yeah.
What if
they're
a lawsuit?
Other people?
What do you mean? What's bugging them?
I don't know. Like, harassing a couple or something.
If it was a girl, then I'd say something. But, if it's a guy, it's kind of like.
Whatever.
I mean, if it was some tiny little guy, maybe. But if it's another grown man, it's kind of like, hey, man.
Yeah.
just avoid the situation. I got in a fight with Conor. But what are you going to do? It's like, what are you going to get, a shouting match? What are you going to, literally, what are you going to do? It's almost like arguing with trolls on the internet. What are you going to do?
Well, I was in a fight in Hoboken, New Jersey one time, and the guy had my legs, and I was trying to punch him. And somebody tried to break it up, and these other two dudes who were kind of athletes, they go, no, what are you doing, man? Let him fight. Let him fight.
Let him get it out.
I remember hearing that so clearly. And then I had to cut him.
You had to cut him.
I had to put my blade. I caught my blade.
Yeah, I cut him. I don't. It's just not worth it, man. And what do you really? I mean, if someone like bumped into my kid or knocked his, you know, his stroller over or did something like that, then yeah, I'm gonna.
Can I go back to why you were so certain that this would be a decision for Conor?
Yeah.
Why?
So what happens when you're 45 minutes later?
I know, I'm sorry.
Broke it all down.
You know, I'm sorry.
Twice. What we haven't talked about, though, is this was by far, at least in my experience, the most star-studded UFC event. And I've been to a lot.
Kanye West was there.
A lot of UFC events. This is the most huge, like legit A of A-list celebrities I've ever seen in a UFC audience.
And it shows you how big of a star Conor is.
More than 200, more than 196.
It shows you how big of a pull Conor has. Because whenever there's that greatness, other celebrities want to be around to see what makes him special. Like, if you think of like an epic, like a Michael Jackson, like the celebrities are fans of him. They look up to him. With Conor and fighting, most celebrities can't relate to that. Even basketball, football. So he has this mystic kind of vibe about him. Kanye West, who you can't get much bigger celebrity-wise, even his ass came out to check.
Howard was at fucking open workouts.
Do you know what
you
got?
Just showing up to that. Like,
that shows you the magnitude. Again, and if this fight, pay-per-view number-wise, doesn't break records, we're in some trouble.
Do you know what I think got it from this? You know what I got from this? I got a lot of inspiration. When I watched Conor McGregor coming out, and I watched him being introduced, the stakes were so high for him.
So serious.
And I was like, this guy has such balls to come back at 170 after getting dominated like that, or at least beaten up in the second round. And to have the courage to really believe, and to believe not only that he was going to win, but to the sort of standing there alone. And I saw him look down, and he was kind of talking to himself. And there's nothing more lonely. It's just up to you, only you in that octagon. That was very inspiring. The idea that he's just that courageous, that just, you know, if he can do that, then it's for me, it was like there's no reason to be afraid of anything in some ways. I don't know. That's what I got from it, man.
I didn't get that. I mean, that's cool. You got that from that. To me, it was more just, I mean, you're talking about possibly top five greatest fights of all time. Like, it's.
You mean as far as the fight itself and what happened?
From the magnitude of the fight, how much hype is around that fight for it to actually deliver and then some. Mm. We've never had that. Think about Brock Marquant. Think how much hype was in that fight. That fight was shit.
Right.
People were pissed. Think about a fight that actually delivered.
It's unbelievable. Five rounds of just banging.
And the other thing that's weird is a lot of people forget is Conor came out because the one knock on Nate is always leg kicks. If you want to slow him down, you do leg kicks. Conor's not a leg kicker. That's not his forte.
Broke his foot.
But that's what he worked on in camp. So that first, second round when he's throwing his leg kicks, it's like investments in a bank. You're not going to see a return right away. Third, fourth, fifth round, you get a return. So that first, second round, you move, kick those legs out. Fourth, fifth round, you're banking on those catching up to him, and you're getting your money back.
Did you think, because this is the first thing that came to my mind when Conor's teammate, Artem Lobov, came out and fought Avila and started throwing leg kicks. I had never seen Artem throw leg kicks really either. Second that started happening, I was like, I think we got some foreshadowing.
100%.
Here. Conor's actually going to have stick to an intelligent game plan, or at least is it planning on sticking to this game plan?
Yeah. The thing that's tough.
That
gave you a little precursor of, oh shit, because camps, you can tell if camps get at one thing, usually they mimic each other. It's a copycat copycat league. So with Conor McGregor throwing those leg kicks, remember, he's not a leg kicker. He's just not. He usually throws head kicks, those spinning kicks. Being a leg kicker is completely different, man. So for him to add that into his repertoire in real lifetime in the biggest fight of his life is so insane. I can't even put into words how insane that
just
is.
It's a testament to his athleticism.
And to pull it off. And no, just his mental toughness. Yeah. We know he's athletic. Leg kicking, we know he can do that. But for him,
it's kind of a timing thing, though. Yeah.
For him to pull it off, timing in real time in an actual fight of that magnitude is fucking nuts. I don't know how many other guys would have the balls to do it.
Well, that's what I mean.
The other thing is, he hurt his foot and shin doing it. So that third round, I'm like, why the fuck does he look so bad? And he, in his interview, he said, my leg, I've never thrown kicks. I'm not a leg kicker. My leg was so fucked up. And yet he's in crutches after the fight.
That's why he was kind of, I was wondering, you're right, because like the third.
He didn't have movement.
At one point, he stopped.
Kept hitting his kneecap, which is basically what ended up breaking Anderson Silva's leg.
Correct. Well, at one point, too, he was standing there, and when they put ice on his stomach, and he kind of closed his eyes, and he put his head down like that, and I went, he's in pain or exhausted. Something's going on here. His leg, man. Damn. So he fought two and a half rounds on a broken foot.
Yeah, get a couple leg kicks checked. See how your leg feels.
Bone to bone. The other thing, there's always some X factors in there with, you know, Nate for 2 weeks didn't spar. He just rode a bike and swam because he hurt his knee, stuff like that. And then, you know, Conor had some issues in camp as well. So you're always going to have that stuff. I don't take that stuff into account. Mm-hmm. I don't.
Everybody gets injured, right?
No one's ever been 100% healthy. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, if you have like a torn ACL, MCL, then we're talking about a game changer. But, you know, if you can still perform like they did, it's a level playing field. So mm-hmm. Nate Diaz would never make an excuse. You know what I'm saying? I think Rogan, Goldie were saying, I'd love to know how bad his camp was. You're taken away from the magnitude of what Conor just pulled off.
How bad Nate's camp was?
Yes.
Is that what they said?
Yeah.
No, I'm not watching the broadcast.
Yeah, yeah. They're like, I'd love to hear what exactly Nate's referring to about his camp, blah, blah. I don't care. Mm. I really don't. I don't calculate that in. No one's that healthy. Unless you have some crazy meniscus, ACL, MCL, shoulder, broken wrist, broken hand, something like that. If you're just injured, that's pretty typical.
Yeah.
But what you can't do is go, oh, he didn't have a full camp. He kind of came in injured. Yeah. That he didn't really fight the real Nate. Yeah, he did. Nate threw everything in the kitchen sink at Conor McGregor, and Conor still won.
It feels like Nate, though, is going to be, for this third fight, easy to plan for unless he changes something. But Nate is stubborn.
He's not changing anything.
Boxing, jiu-jitsu. No takedowns. No kicks. Uh-uh. I'm going to be heavy on that front leg, and I'm going to box you and do the exact same.
But remember, now it's at 55, which is Nate's natural weight.
But that's
also
hard for him to suck down to, isn't it?
No. He has more fights at 55.
Isn't it harder?
He's actually a natural 55-er.
But is that bad? Isn't it bad for him to have to suck more?
He's been doing
weight?
It.
Right.
He might have better cardio, too.
Better cardio? But that's 15 pounds of weight he has to lose. So I'd imagine he'd be dehydrated, so he might be
dehydrated.
But he never gets tired anyway.
But he's also a natural 55-er. Because 70 is not his natural weight class. Now you can say, well, he's carrying more weight, blah, blah, blah. No. 55 is going to be lighter. He's going to be faster. He's going to have better cardio. 55, an Nate Diaz at 55 is a tough, tough task for Conor. It's a tougher fight for him. Nate wanted the fight at 55, remember?
Really?
Nate's asked for both fights at 55.
I didn't know that.
Conor's one that won at 70.
But why would Nate feel better sucking that much weight?
It's just his natural weight. Like, he's maybe doesn't feel as strong. Maybe his cardio's not as good. Mm-hmm. Like, he goes, I don't have abs at 70. This is stupid. Like, I don't do the same training that I usually do. Like, I'm trying to.
Oh, I see.
So he's bulking. It's not natural for him. So at 50, 55 for Conor versus Nate is not favorable.
Result for you?
I don't know. I'd have to think about it.
One thing about the.
They're not fighting next, right?
They are not fighting.
No, Dana said not happening. Okay. He wants to get over this trilogy.
Yeah. Well, okay.
Do you hate money?
I don't understand that.
Did you talk about like the? I don't think we've talked about it yet. Like the complaints of Conor like running.
Like I said, yeah, I noted on it. No, it's not. It's not a foot thing. It has nothing to do with it. Remember, people get so evil and nasty about this stuff. It's okay if you love the Nate Diaz and you love Conor. There's no need to be mean to each other. It's stupid to argue if a guy thinks another guy won. It's very people really need to work on being a critical thinker and not being a hater, because you can take that fifth round where Conor's turning his back and running, trying to run out the clock, because you already knew he had three rounds in the bank. Why? And you're exhausted. You're fighting a bigger guy. You can say running, blah, blah, blah. If I'm a Conor McGregor fan, I'm saying, well, my guy knocked your guy on his ass three times.
Right.
So give me that 10-8 round in the second.
And lit him up in general.
Yeah. So so you can't take certain aspects and create memes saying he's running here.
Right.
When for three rounds he demolished
him. Being strategic.
But it's in that magnitude of a fight, you're fighting a bigger guy, you're exhausted, he's bigger in the clinch. Like, it was frustrating me. He was so much bigger. Conor came and turned – turn and control the clinch, really.
Right.
Nate would just lay on. He's so much bigger.
Yeah.
So those don't work for me, man. You can't pick and choose like, oh, he ran, so he lost. No, he didn't. He did a masterful piece of art against a way bigger guy. Yeah, exactly. Beat him three out of two rounds.
Exactly.
That third round was scary, though.
Unbelievable. Yeah. But his accuracy, and he proved that even against a longer, bigger guy, he's just a way better boxer, right?
I don't know if you can say better. I think he's a different kind of. I don't think you can say that. I don't think you say better boxer. I think he's quicker. He was more efficient with power strikes. But I think Nate, in general, as a boxer, is better.
Really?
Yes.
Huh. But I feel like Nate didn't. It was just because he made it slower. It just couldn't put.
He
his
landed
hand
more shots
on Connor. Yes. I didn't see that at all.
Yeah, yeah.
Glancing though, right?
Not doesn't not matter shots. If you look at the time strike numbers. Diaz
so
landed
he,
more shots.
He did.
Yes.
Wow.
But then you look at significant. But he also has a higher output.
Okay.
See, the problem is you can't say this guy's a better boxer because he knocked him on his ass and landed more right hands or left hands. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because the MMA fight.
Right.
So it's
MMA
tough.
Wise, it looked like he.
I wouldn't say he's a better boxer. I'd say he's a better striker, and he used it more efficiently as far as making it count when he landed. Mm-hmm. But in general, if that's a boxing match, Nate wins.
It just looked like Connor was not taking any real shots to the head unless he was in the clinch where he got some elbows.
Yeah,
and stuff.
Yeah. But no, he did a much good. Better job. Remember, the other thing with Nate Diaz, one thing that never gets tired or slows down is size and reach. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter.
Yeah.
That the Nate's advantage of size and reach is there in minute of round one and the end of round five. That never goes away. You can't.
And I thought that for sure in 25 minutes he was going to, with his bigger size, he was going to connect to Connor's face enough to just stop him, or at least to just so that he could capitalize.
Daze him,
and he didn't do that.
I was more worried about Nate getting wearing him down in the clinch, especially in the fourth or fifth, and getting either like an inside leg trip or just dropping down and just pulling his legs out from under him, which he got really, really close.
Really
He got a deep, deep double.
Connor's takedown defense is impressive, man. It gets a bigger guy.
Way, way better.
Really.
You know what I wish I would have seen? Is Connor jumped to guard.
Really?
Connor had pulled guard?
Nate Diaz pulled guard.
That's what I was waiting for.
In the first and second round. You know why he doesn't? Ego.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think he could have made Connor way more tired and put him more on his heels if he would have pulled guard in that first second round.
Yeah.
That's when Connor's most dangerous.
Just get like double unders and just drop down?
Get one underhook and just pull him on top of you in half guard and go to work. Even if you're not going to submit him, but he's constantly defending, he's going to try to pull back, you just control his posture, you're going to wear Connor out. Because Connor's forte is on his feet.
If
you bring him down to your ground.
See, I thought, speaking of the ego thing, when Connor knocked him down, I was really worried.
Me too.
Every single time that it happened, that he was going to dive into
me
that
too.
And get fucking...
I was like, no, let him back up. Let him up. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was scary, man. But it's going to be interesting what they do with him.
Be interesting to see if Nate takes that advice, because somebody's got to be telling them that. Jump to half guard.
It's not their style. It's not their style. And at 55, his camp believes he can beat him. They're going to do the exact same thing. It's a tough fight for Connor at 55, man.
You know what's really cool also? And I don't know if I've ever actually seen this at a UFC event before, but maybe it's just the magnitude of the fight. I've never seen a crowd so positively responsive to a ton of clinch work against a cage.
Well, it's just so
at
exciting.
No point was
so
there
exciting.
That magnitude of fight.
Active clinch work.
You know what surprised me is it wasn't sold out. I think it's because of the new T-Mobile Arena. I don't think
2,700 tickets. I don't think they sold, and it was because most of them were premium tickets. They were between $365 and $1,800.
And because they weren't linked to a casino, and they give whalers those tickets and they give them discounts, so you have 2,000 some tickets unsold.
Yeah,
which of the magnitude of that?
T-Mobile Arena is like right across from the Monte Carlo. Which is kind of a weird spot. Like it's close to the MGM and it's close to Aria and it's close to like a
lot of big hotels.
But it's not something you're gonna walk right past on your way to something huge. You know, it's kind of like a standalone little figure right there.
They need to figure that out, because for that thing not to sell out is no bueno.
Who do you want to see Conor fight next? Eddie Alvarez.
God, we've been over this. We can do it again if you want for the listeners.
We don't have to.
I mean, we can talk about it after too. They've literally I broke it down for 45 minutes. Yeah. We've gone over it.
What did you say?
Floyd Mayweather. So we'll fight next.
Floyd Mayweather?
Mm-hmm.
Be a terrible idea.
Yeah. No, it's a great idea.
Why is it a great idea? It's the dumbest idea I've ever heard.
He's
going to
get $40 million.
I mean, but he's not going to be able to box with Floyd.
Doesn't matter. $40 million.
It's ridiculous. I have no interest in seeing that.
Let's go to some current events with Evan the Cub.
Evan the
it's
guy.
Game time decision.
Evan the guy.
It just depends.
The
beard.
Yeah, it's always a game time decision. Whatever you're feeling like today, Evan the.
Sometimes,
it's
just Evan the.
Were you working like crazy this weekend? Not was it nonstop?
Yep. All.
Hey, did you hear? Who we forgot to mention, Cody Garbrandt.
And, oh, I was there.
And Dominic Cruz almost fought.
I was with Dominic.
What? What happened?
I was with him when it happened.
What happened?
We were walking into to the production trucks in the back through the back door of the arena, and they're bringing Cody in from the freight entry.
In his suit.
So the fighters, yeah, he's suited up. Dom's suited up. Cause, you know, he's about to go get ready for the pre-fight show because this is before anything starts. So Cody just got there. Dom and I and another PA are going up over the pre-fight set, and it was two pit bulls coming up and sniffing each other and getting and it wasn't a friendly sniff.
Who
at
started
all.
Dominic? I would imagine.
Oh, they just both of them. They just both beelined. They just walked straight towards.
And start talking shit to each other.
Cody's walking in directly towards us. We're walking directly towards the door that he just came in through. It had to happen. Like they were going straight for each other, regardless.
They have to be separated.
DC separated them, yeah.
DC did?
Yeah, Daniel was trailing like 20
Yeah, because you guys
are
getting ready
like,
to break it up. And,
I mean, it's like me, Dominic, and another PA who weighs like 160 pounds. I'm not getting in there.
Good luck stopping those boys.
No chance. Like, these guys are nose to nose.
And so DC separates them? Yeah. No, obviously no fists were thrown.
Yeah, DC separated them. And it was funny. I was talking to Dominic a little bit later about it. He's like, DC hadn't stepped in, that's 100% a fist fight in the hallway.
100%.
Within maybe 10 more seconds.
Jesus.
Dom's way too competitive. Just let him walk by and not stir up some.
Damn.
He's like, that was a T-minus 10-second countdown before it was a full-blown fight.
That's a great fight, man. Like, you know me, I like when guys take the time to get to the title shot. But with Cody Garbrandt just murking Mizugaki like that, it's
iced him good.
And it's a freaking, God, man, he's a good matchup for Dom. So he's like the Anthony Johnson of that division. He reminds me a lot of Chuck Liddell. Great takedown offense. Crazy power. Like, he touches you at that weight class, you're going to sleep, man.
Speaking of which, did you see Glover's tooth go flying in the air after he got caught with that uppercut?
We sure did.
You already talked about it.
Yeah, in depth. What else you got, Ev? Let's go to current events.
Right. I can't recall who put the GIF together, but someone did an amazing video of Glover's tooth comes out. And they just animated it so it skyrocketed through the roof of T-Mobile into through the sky into outer space, hits an astronaut, bounces off and like hits a planet and it explodes.
Like, that uppercut
well
was from outer space.
Jesus Christ.
All right, Dad, let's go to current events, buddy.
All right. First current event we got. I mean, this is might as well be three current events rolled up into one. USA Wrestling and just wrestling in general at the Olympics provided some great, great moments. One, we got Helen Mrulis.
Yeah.
I don't quite know how to pronounce her last name. Wins the first American woman to win a gold medal. Takes out that Japanese girl, Yoshida, I think, who hadn't lost in like... You look at her Wikipedia, it's just gold medal, gold medal, gold medal, gold medal, gold medal, gold medal. Insane. Takes her out. Gold medal for the U.S. Kyle Snyder breaks Henry Cejudo's record for youngest
20 years old.
20 years old. Youngest American.
Shit.
To ever win a gold medal at the Olympics.
That's incredible.
Which makes him a NCAA champion, a national champion, and a gold medal.
I'd say wrestling is what he's supposed to do.
Not youngest American to win a gold medal. Youngest person to win a gold medal in wrestling.
Period.
Yes.
Yes, yes. Not in Olympics in general, because
wrestling.
18,
plenty
19
of,
year olds.
Teenagers who won.
In gymnastics and whatever.
Yeah, so and there's a cool little caveat to the Kyle Snyder one. I don't know if Helen has anything like this, but Snyder gets a $250,000 bonus that he can keep from a USA Wrestling fund that somehow is approved by the NCAA.
Sick.
And he gets to keep it all.
What?
And
where is he going to college?
Ohio State.
Shit, that's awesome.
Yeah, so he can't make. Obviously, he can't make any money through the NCAA, but since it's a fund, it somehow bypasses the NCAA laws or whatever.
Tight move, man.
Yeah, he gets 250 grand, so good on USA Wrestling for having that in place.
Mm-hmm. Dude, USA clean shop at the Olympics. Almost doubled everyone else's Olympics medals. Yeah. Just destroyed everybody.
Yeah. So those are the two great ones from the U.S. And then, I mean, the internet was a buzz the other day with the Mongolian wrestling coaches.
Taking their clothes off?
Yeah, taking their clothes off.
Protesting?
They stripped down basically to their underwear.
Terrible bodies. Terrible bodies.
Yeah, not the best bodies.
Terrible bodies.
Yeah. Somebody's not been missing any meals.
Hey, fellas, let's go ahead and not do that.
Yeah, I'm taking my clothes off the next time I'm pissed.
They should ban you guys from the next Olympics for taking your shirt off.
There's something interesting about that. I'm taking all my fucking clothes off and national team.
What kind of reaction is that?
It made a statement, I guess not a good way.
What happens when you come back to Mongolia? What does your president do? Hey.
Dude, did you
way
see?
Strip down.
Yeah, what the fuck is with taking off?
Way to represent, man.
Maybe that's a Mongolian tradition if you're flipping out. You're like, I'm fucking taking my clothes off.
Did you see the Olympic lifters? Like the power lifters? Have you seen those guys?
Yeah.
They're insanely out of shape. Huge guts.
They have huge guts.
Albanian, and they're just these hairy fucking dudes.
I guess it's
doing like 700 pounds of calorie. You think, doctor? Yeah.
Well, they have to take in a lot of food, I guess, for recovery. That's what I heard.
Fucked. No. They're fat. They're just really strong. No, it has nothing to do. They're just
huge
fat.
Caloric intake.
Because the more they weigh, it's a super heavyweight. So obviously, the more you weigh, the more weight you can do. So they're just fat, big dudes.
Just eat as much
as Albanian. They want. The one guy was from, I think he was Iraqi.
Literally every one of them has a belly. It's crazy.
Like belly, like insanely obese.
But what is that? Why is that? Fat, big, is that just guys. Like a tradition, kind of like the uniform of a powerlifter, or?
Well, I think if you're 240 pounds and shredded, you're not gonna put up the weight. The more you weigh, the more weight you're gonna put up.
You think so?
No, I know. No, I'm telling you.
But why That's would a belly of why would belly fat help you with that?
There's big dudes. So these guys weigh 370, 380 pounds.
Right.
Like you look at the world's strongest man. They're not small. No one's under really 300. They're all big dudes. Like big, strong dudes.
So, but a lot of those guys who are the world's strongest men don't have bellies. And these guys do, which is weird.
I would say the world's strongest aren't the cleanest. It's a big difference.
Now, different testing.
Now you might be
different.
Now you might be onto something.
And
sir.
It's also one's power lit like an actual sport, and then right, one's right, obviously right. Like pulling trucks mm-hmm. and shit. Yeah, those guys are.
Yeah,
I was watching. I'm like, oh my god, why are they so fat? Even the women are big too, though. Like the super heavyweight women are big.
Yeah, for sure.
They're big.
Gigante.
Yeah, gigantes.
What
sure.
else you got?
Gigante.
Next one. Did you see any of the post-fight interviews with Diaz or McGregor?
Yeah.
I did not.
Diaz, about 10 minutes in, starts smoking weed.
No, it wasn't weed, though.
It was a weed pen.
See, I thought it was
CBD oil, which is a derivative of marijuana.
Was it marijuana?
It's basically a weed pen.
He's still on the clock.
I thought it was
hookah. It's hookah?
Yeah.
You need, the whole... Like for that.
You're saying like a nicotine hookah? No, they do have pens like hookah.
No, it was a CBD oil pen. And
see,
cannabinoid, it's a derivative of marijuana. It's basically a weed pen.
If they tested him, he's going to test positive, man.
So what I read was that he's good here. Because so he submits his post-fight test like right off the bat. So by the time he gets to media, he's already submitted his post-fight sample. And... I guess you just need a 6-hour window for post fight stuff as before you can basically start like getting buck wild. So as long as he wasn't tested again with it, like tested twice within 6 hours of finishing the fight, he's good.
He's in the clear.
Yeah, he's in the clear. Wait, I just thought it was a whole.
So you can smoke weed. You can smoke weed when you're not training.
As long as you're not in camp, or as long as it's weird, if you're not in camp and you're not in, it's not the week of the fight or before competition, you can.
Really? I didn't know that. Huh. Makes sense.
Yeah, it's based
on different rules too. Like you're not going to spend it as long if you test positive. Right.
So here's what it says. It says, for some reason, the UFC USADA anti-doping contract changes the definition of in competition testing to include a period of up to 6 hours post-bout. So in competition, meaning the period commencing 6 hours prior to the commencement of the scheduled weigh-in and ending 6 hours after the conclusion of the bout. So assuming Nate provided a sample to the NSAC before vaping,
which
and
he
assuming
did.
That sample comes back negative, then he's good. He won't have an anti-doping
Now, can you
violation.
Do you have to take urine test and blood test or just urine after a fight?
I think it depends. But it wouldn't matter with that weed. It doesn't matter.
So yeah, as long as
he's good.
Yeah.
Everyone was worried. Yeah.
It was a great Diaz. It was a classic Diaz.
Classic. And you hear Diaz say he's not going to fight anyone unless it's Conor. Like he goes, I'll wait. I'm not taking any.
So he's and why did and Dana said that it's not going to happen.
Dana said, I want to move on. There's not going to be a trilogy anytime soon. The next fight for Conor is either Eddie Alvarez at 55 or Jose Aldo at 45. That's it. And with Nate, you know, he's not fighting unless it's Conor. So
get that money, man.
Get smart. Right. And he has $2 million in the bank, so you're good. What else you got?
Show for a little bit.
Yeah.
Plenty of enough money to buy all the vape pens for the rest of his life.
Hopefully he's not paying for those.
Yeah. I think I'm pretty sure he's a vape sponsor.
How do him and his brother not have their own weed shop? I have no idea.
In stock.
In stock. Invest that $2 million into weed, and you're gonna make some money. What else you got?
All right. Last two. We'll just roll up the last two Olympics things into one. Ryan Lochte, liar, called it. Two, Speedo's already dropped him as a sponsor. Three, Bovada actually.
So did Polo.
Yeah. and three, Bovada, the online sports book, actually had a prop bet. Of will Ryan Lochte lose a sponsor over the Rio 2006 antics?
Jesus Christ, what were the odds? I'd bet that all day.
Yeah, yes was a minus 170.
Oh my God, that's easy money.
The easiest money of all time.
Fuck's sake, of course.
So they actually ended up vandalizing a gas station and the security guard held them at gunpoint until the cops got there, right?
It was all exaggerated. Then he went on for Dateline or something like that, was like kind of crying, but didn't. He really didn't apologize.
He said he doesn't know why. He basically said,
he admitted he exaggerated.
I don't know why everyone's all mad.
There wasn't a gun at my head. It was pointing my direction, so let's relax. The thing is your boy Michael Phelps, I don't even know if they're boys. Mike Phelps has had so many fuck-ups. He's lost so many millions of dollars in endorsements. Now he's the golden child. Notice anyone who has these mistakes, the next morning before we all can just shred you to pieces in the media, the next morning Mike Phelps went, my bad, I did smoke weed, I did do this, I'm working on it, I make mistakes, my bad, won't happen again. Then there's nothing to tear
just
you down.
Admit to what
just
you
admit,
did.
I fucked up, I'm doing
that's
my
how
thing,
I feel.
I was partying.
Yeah.
But when you try to manipulate and bullshit your way, people will just thrash
That was my
you.
Problem with Tiger Woods. He read from a page, just talk to me, man. You know, he read this kind of rote thing with like, it was just really weird. And I was like, just be like, hey, I fucked up. I'm really sorry. I'm really embarrassed. I'm going to try to be better. It's just really hard. I've always had to be perfect my whole life. And I had so much female attention and I guess I'm kind of weak.
Alex Rodriguez did
like,
the same
no
thing.
No problem.
Rodriguez, they read from his thing. They're also sociopaths. So they're not going to give it like my bad. They can't do that. So there's a reason why they're reading. They have very smart people surround them going, no, we don't want that. Because you have them talk, they're like, what the fuck you want me to do? Yeah, you know what I'm saying? You can't have that. Because it's like asking a serial killer to apologize
to
victims.
They
can't. So they have them read. So with Ryan Lochte, it's just, I don't know, it's tough, man. He has Tool written all over him. And this, you know what I'm saying? Like, this isn't helping him. He just
funny.
Does, doesn't he? He just,
I think so, too.
Like, he's not going to come out here and
he's
be our friend.
He's got Tool written on. Yeah, he's just.
He's just kind of like.
He's a very good-looking, tall swimmer. And, I know what you mean.
I mean, I celebrate the fact that he dyed his hair. I did the same shit, but it's just.
He looks like he belongs on a yacht, and he wouldn't be your friend anyway. Like, he'd be like, not you, you peasant. You know?
No.
There's something about him, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know what it is, but it's. We're not going to get a bear with that guy.
Yeah,
like, we're
already,
not going to.
He already looks like the bad guy in the movie. Like, kind of like.
He looks like the snitch. You know what I'm saying? Like, you can't trust him.
He's got, like, the dumb jock thing going on, but not in, like, an endearing way, where, like, you only want to be, like, hang out. He's fun to hang out with. He's, like, unintentional.
No, it's not like the frat boy thing.
Yeah, he's just a.
It's, you just look at him like, I don't want to be that guy's friend. It sucks, man.
I wouldn't like
just,
anywhere in my general vicinity.
He says that I'm a Tool look. I don't know. It's weird. So when he got caught, I was like, God damn it.
Tool is an underused word.
Because then he was like, yeah, the gun was in my face. And I was like, fucking do it, man. What's up? When as soon as he said that, I'm like, oh, you're lying.
Oh, boy.
You weren't here, but as soon as I saw him, oh, he's lying. It was before all this came out, I went, oh, he's
nobody
lying.
Nobody says that.
He's lying. Yeah. Because
only Tim
as a
Kennedy
swimmer, as a swimmer, no, even Tim Kaye wouldn't do that.
Right.
You're not to fucking sense. Do it. Let me see what happens. No, no, no. You're a swimmer in Brazil. And you had white jeans on.
You American
and
white jeans
you said
jeans
you went
swimmer.
To the ground, and I've had white jeans. I came drink coffee. And you were not on that Brazilian soil on your face.
You lie.
I literally called. As soon as he told me the story, how I have, I went, oh, no. He's lying.
And more importantly,
he made all of it up.
More importantly,
but let's move on.
You lied to make yourself look bad.
But also, let's move on.
Yeah, I don't give a fuck.
I'm so fucked.
I don't give a fuck.
You know, can I be honest? I'm so glad the Olympics are done. I'm fucking sick of them. They're about 2 weeks too long for me. I'd like a week of just epic Olympic coverage, and after that, let's move on.
Also, that's I'm a lie. That's a lie. That Lochte lie's a lie. I can give a shit about. I don't give a fuck.
Hey, media, you got to move on. Ugh. I don't give a fuck. He swims.
He made up a story. You know, and he was with his boys. I might have made up a story too. I don't fucking know. Not to make myself look good.
I don't think his boys are very much his boys right now.
They snitched on him like this.
They did.
They're not his boys. They're just on the swim team. They're all fucking
threw him under the fucking bus.
Well, but also the boys, they got them off the plane and questioned them. They were like, "He made that shit up. It never happened."
Like they immediately, "I'll sing like a canary."
They snitched right away. We're swimmers.
if Lachlan I'm lying. Makes up some bullshit. Brings me into the whole thing. It makes me look like I might have been a part of this nonsense also. Then flees the country, leaving my ass there. You are goddamn right I'm taking you down.
No shit. 100%.
I'm actually going to call the homeboy from the Vice thing. He's going to run a train on you. I'm going to film it.
Yeah. So they didn't lie. They didn't lie. He's the one.
They didn't say anything. They went silent and was like, "I guess do your thing, man." And then when they started taking heat from, like, "This is way bigger of a deal than we thought."
Yeah.
He's lying.
Yeah. I'm not gonna fuck me in your nonsense.
Yeah, fuck you, man.
What are you doing?
Yeah, what can you do? What else you got, Ev?
All right, last one we got. This is from last night. So WWE SummerSlam was last night. It's a big deal. One of the big wrestling events of the year. Brock Lesnar was taking on Randy Orton in the final, or in the main event.
The anticipation.
Your boy went off script and beat the fuck out of him.
I saw Lesnar, it. I watched it this morning. I don't know if I'd say off script.
You think it was just part of the deal?
I do.
Because he opened a monstrous gash that needed 10 staples to close.
Yeah.
And there's some video online of Lesnar elbowing him on the ground and like the thud. He legit knocked like...
But he like crawls them out and then he's like kidding them, you know, and then he opens his arms very calculated and then throws an elbow and the Randy Orton like rolls over. So it kind of, you know, after UFC 202 and you have those crossover fans, they turn into WWE, you're going to have some similarities. So it's very convenient for me that he gets cut and he rolls over and it stopped like an MMA fight. Get the fuck out of my face.
I mean, do you think that they planned for that? Real elbow to go?
Look at me. It's all fake. It's all scripted.
The blood
and stitches are real, sir. And I get it. You're crazy in the back if you don't think Randy Orton was like, "Yeah, you can elbow me in the face and cut stitches." No, yeah, I know.
It's real.
It's also on the top of his head.
Yeah.
Big difference.
By the way, they have a lot of scar tissue up there. They take a lot of those shots, and that's the first place they get hit.
Not that it doesn't hurt or that really didn't happen. But you're batshit crazy and can't be my friend if you don't think that was playing in the back. And you're also fucking crazy if you don't think they rehearsed that about 70 times before that.
To be fair, other guys in the WWE have complained, even when Lesnar wasn't actually in the organization at the time.
He's too rough.
No, they said that he goes off script, like, all the time. Like, it sucks wrestling him because he'll actually, like, punch you in the face, like, multiple times.
Well, because he's a fighter, because he's a real guy. Because he's adapting to what's going on.
He forgets. Is this an MMA fight or a wrestling match?
Yeah, I don't know. It's WWE. Not, it's tough for me to be like, "No, that's crazy, man. He did what? It's so stupid. I just can't get into it, man. Michael Rapport sent me that link this morning and went, "Dude, Brock's going nuts." I went, "Don't ever send me a WWE link again. He's not going nuts. They scripted that. Please don't send that ever again." He put, "All right." What else you got, Ev?
That was going to be it, but I'm just reading this headline on Barstool, and the headline is just, "Paul Wall is offering a free grill to every single American athlete who won gold in Rio."
God damn. It's a lot of gold. A lot of gold grills.
He runs a pretty lucrative grill shop down in Houston.
I think they won 37 gold medals. I mean, that's a lot of expensive gold.
That's a lot of grills.
I would take one if I was a gold medal winner.
Oh, hell yeah. Put gold medal and a Paul Wall grill next to it.
I wonder what Paul Wall, that's all he does these days?
He runs a pretty good grill, lucrative apparently, grill shop.
I'm so sorry, but who is Paul Wall?
Rapper.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, white rapper from Houston, Texas.
Wow.
He was big for a while.
Yeah.
That's what he does now, huh? That's cool.
Now he owns grills.
Is that it, Ev? I'll take a grill.
Hey, if you wanted to have his phone number.
Ah, fuck. Can you imagine me with a grill? Why do you have his phone number?
One of my friends worked on a commercial with him like years ago, and he apparently hasn't changed his phone number in like 7 years, and every now and then they'll like prank call him. It's actually really funny.
And does he answer?
His voicemail is just him saying, "What it do?
What it do, bitch?
Message, what it do?
What it do? I'm gonna change mine to that. People are like, what the? What it do? What it I don't do, even know how to respond to that. How do you think that? What it do? What am I? What are you doing? I'm sorry. It's Brendan. I'm looking for a grill. I don't know. It's so weird, man. Oh, that's awesome. You guys have his phone number, though. Is that it, Ev?
Yeah.
All right,
that's
man.
A wrap.
Boom.
Got us a little dropping knowledge. Do you guys know, and this is going to, I'm going to extrapolate on this. Do you know what kamikaze, you know who the kamikaze were?
Yeah.
Who were they?
They were pilots, kamikaze, right? And they'd fly in, basically suicide bombers.
Yes. Do you know where they were from?
Japan.
Yes.
Any other brain busters?
Do you know what kamikaze means?
Crazy.
No.
What?
Not bad. It means divine wind. And the majority of, they were volunteers, most of them. And the majority of the volunteers, essentially, first of all, it was toward the end of the war. And they thought that, you know, they were essentially told that there would be the end of Japan if they lost. And so a lot of these people were volunteering to save their country. But most of them were philosophy majors. There were a lot of, most of them were highly educated. They were young. They were idealistic. They were liberal. They were political science majors for what the equivalent was that they were university students. They were not engineers. They were not mathematicians.
They literally thought it was going to be the end of Japan. Well, they were sacrificing their lives for it.
They were romantic.
They sound like suicide bombers.
They
were ISIS and Muslims.
Now you're starting to put things together.
Well,
because there's this idea that people go to war because they hate. And in fact, the way you mobilize armies and the way you create fanatics is the exact opposite. Historically, men go to war over symbology, propaganda, and an idea or ideas. And usually those
ideas... Well, these days for money though, right?
Not really. People are not willing to die for money. That's a different situation where there's a lot of money involved and countries get
oil.
Involved. But I'm saying when you talk about fanatics, when you talk about terrorists, when you talk about ISIS, when you talk about not the people that orchestrate the ISIS, but the people that are willing to die for a cause.
The actual ISIS, yeah.
And that's kind of what happens. And most of them would write these poems home. These haikus to their families before they died. Like there's one that said, asked about the soul of Japan, I would say that it is like wild cherry blossoms glowing in the morning sun. They would write these really kind of like, you know, and then they would go and die. And they were dying
I'd be pissed if someone wrote me that before
right.
I died.
Right, here's something
for
from-
For sure get more creative.
Here's something from the Kamikaze Pilot's Manual. Watch this. When you eliminate all thoughts about life and death, you will be able to totally disregard your earthly life. This will also enable you to concentrate your attention on eradicating the enemy with unwavering determination, meanwhile reinforcing your excellence in flight skills.
It's very similar to the email I get from Dana White when I retired from the UFC.
That's right. And the bottom line is, again, it goes back to this thing. So these men were indoctrinated in an ideology that they were willing to kill and die for. We see this over and over again.
There's a 12-year-old suicide bomber at wedding in Turkey.
That's right.
He was 12.
Yeah, because that's what ISIS is now reverting to because they don't have any other choice. They're losing so many of their fighters. They're drugging these kids, they think, maybe even. And the bottom line is we know that people are willing to do whatever it takes. Now, here's the lesson.
They believe in the bigger picture.
But here's the lesson.
They're going to heaven with how many virgins.
Yeah, yeah. We spend so much time condemning people for what they think as opposed to how they think. I always talk about this. It's about how you think because what you think, a lot of times, if you were in the situation that a lot of people were, and these were humanity students.
Talking about the Japanese in World War II?
If you were in those situations, you may come to the same conclusion that your enemy does. And the enemy wasn't that they were thinking, I'm going to bomb myself. All of us would die for a cause, depending on if we thought it was noble enough, and they did. That's not as relevant. What matters is how they think. And it was the Japanese fanatical devotion to authority their refusal to ever question authority.
Same with the Nazis, though. Do you say same thing? 100%.
Yeah. You were talking about two of the most disciplined societies in the world, the German society back then and the Japanese society. And it was marked by a fanatical devotion to doctrine and to what you were told by your superior. Correct. And to never question those above you. That was considered taboo. And we live in a different world where we do. So at the end of the day, my lesson to you is think for yourself and always judge somebody on how they think, not what they think.
And if someone says, hey, strap this bomb to your chest, you say, fuck you.
That's right. That's the
That'd be the lesson number one.
There's a lesson.
If someone says, hey, put this vest on for me and run that wedding, you say, fuck you.
But here's the lesson. Here's the crazy thing. You and I would strap a bomb to our chest and blow ourselves up if we thought we were saving people we loved or a way of life. We probably would.
For sure.
There are a lot of good people that would do something
100%,
like that.
100%, man.
So remember, think for yourself. Why are you looking at me?
Why are your khakis so tight? Why is your dick in my face? What are those?
I got these.
I can't, they're so distracting.
I got these at Theory.
Your giant piece, your three-piece set is bulging out like it's in saran wrap.
These are a little tight, aren't they?
Well, no, just when you sit down like this, like your dick is in my face.
I know.
Yeah, I can see your entire
You can
piece
see it like
here.
Your ball set is just hanging
set on me.
You got a set. You got a three-piece.
Just pushing.
You got a three-piece kettlebell
tenting
set.
Tenting my fabric.
You got a three-piece fucking tee set
it's
down
tenting.
There.
It's tenting.
No, it's not tenting.
Pants.
It's just like, it's like a bag of like
just
of like
plums?
Brats in like saran wrap.
Brats.
Just brats and like old brats.
It was just hanging like brat.
But as you're doing that drop notch, I'm a suicide bombers. I'm like, God damn it.
You're looking at a sack of brat.
The scrotum is in my face.
You're looking at a sack of brat. I'm hanging brat.
A kamikaze dick.
Hanging brat.
Suicide bomb in your eyeballs.
Yeah, man.
I was hanging brat. That's our new saying. I was
hanging brat, man.
You're hanging brat.
I love a summer brat. Bro, I'll tell you what. I went to my boy's house and he was grilling.
Yeah.
I said, you got to let me get on that grill because where I'm at now, I don't have a grill.
Right.
Dude, in Denver, I used to grill so much. I grilled these fucking burgers. He made T-bones. God, I love a grill. In the summer,
you
nothing
grill
better.
Master?
Grill master. Learn from Papa Shab.
Yeah?
Dad's a grill master.
All right.
You got a grill at your house?
Yeah.
Simply too far.
Yeah, we'll see.
All right.
Well, that's all in current. So who do we got coming in?
We got Ben Henderson, the smooth one, also known as Benda, one of the, you'd say top 10 greatest UFC fighters of all time.
100%.
You look at his resume, WC, UFC. Now he's in Bellator.
Yeah.
Which, you know, and he fights this Friday on Spike TV. You guys can watch him there against the Pitbull.
Fought everybody.
He's fought everyone, and I'm sure we'll get into it. I'd love to see him, test his skills against, like, a Michael Chandler. But we'll get into it. Like I said, there's not much left for that guy. He's a legend.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, Ben Henderson. We got my brother from another mother. The old Denver alumni, Ben Smooth Henderson, is in the building.
Thank you guys for having me.
What's
man?
Up, brother? Long time, man. I've wanted you on here for a while.
Yeah, I've heard a lot about it. Big fan. And I got to shout out my boy, Christopher Zubricki, who loves you guys.
Really?
He loves you. He gave me a full write-up. He emailed me, oh, you got to go over this. You got to go over this. You got to talk about this.
I love it, man.
Yeah. Like, he went in depth.
Is Christopher a fighter?
He's a real estate agent and actually one of our best training partners.
Oh,
he's
okay.
A high-level jiu-jitsu practitioner.
Jesus.
Yeah. You got a lot of jiu-jitsu where you guys are at, right?
Yeah, a ton of jiu-jitsu. Down in Arizona, the jiu-jitsu community is huge down there.
Why is it so big down there? Because when you think jiu-jitsu, you don't think Arizona.
Nah,
granted, I think about Bader, and there's a hotbed for MMA.
Yes,
but I don't think jiu-jitsu.
Yeah,
until you and Crouch moved out there.
I think just the mindset of like the Old West, as far as MMA is concerned, why is it such a hotbed?
Yeah,
like the Old West mentality, showdown, shootout, guns still legal out there. Everyone walks around with a pistol on their head, and they have gravitated towards combat sports, MMA, jiu-jitsu, all of it.
The weather also, though. I mean, the weather also kind of lets you work out outside or just it's not as...
Or not like, work out outside.
Well, yeah.
It's so
summer's ridiculous.
We just did a show in Phoenix, and we got off the plane, and it was 10 o'clock at night, and I was like, is this for real? Like,
yeah,
I thought it was just the air from the buses blowing
exactly.
my face.
Who opened up the massive blow dryer?
It's pretty bad. I really, for me, I like the heat. I really do enjoy it. I quite like it. But when it gets to be 105 degrees, still triple digits, when it's midnight, when it's 1 a.m., that's when I had enough. Can't okay. Do it, son.
Well, this is late. If it's enough for Benson Henderson, then you know there's an issue. Yeah.
And so I'll never forget you. So my very first jiu-jitsu class was with Ben and his coach, Crouch, who is the nicest guy, one of the best of all time.
The man, the myth, the legend.
Wait, yeah. What was your first jiu-jitsu class?
My first jiu-jitsu class ever in this weird Delgado's boxing, and it was Delgado's upstairs.
Yeah. How many years ago?
I don't even know.
That'd be eight, nine years ago.
Yeah. And I remember the class, we were like warming up. I was training with this guy, and the guy's like, dude, you got to relax. I was tense. It's my friend. He's like, you got to relax, man. And then Crouch came over and was just like, hey, man, because they were doing live rolling, and I didn't have enough experience yet to live roll. You know, I need to go. And Crouch goes, hey, watch this kid. Because Ben was rolling with a kid named Alvin Robertson, who's a monster. Yeah. Jiu-Jitsu black belt, fought in the UFC, fought Kenny Florian, fought the who's who. Yeah. And at the time, he was the main thing in Denver. So I knew who Alvin was. And John Crouch goes, hey, watch this kid, Ben. He's a wrestler, but watch him go with Alvin Robinson. Watch this. And it was like some shit I've never seen before. It was like those scraps you see in the Looney Tunes where it's just like the dust kick up and there's all. I was like, oh my God, what is going
the
on?
The dust
here?
Was kicking up.
Alvin threw me a lot of beatings in those days, for sure.
And you only had, the time, one fight.
Yeah.
Yep, I remember
super,
that.
Super early in my career.
Had you been a wrestler for most of your life?
Yeah, I started wrestling in high school.
All-American, right?
Yeah, two-time All-American Dana College.
Yeah, Dana College. And then, so you guys went, what was crazy to me is you and Crouch took a risk and moved from Denver and started your own thing in Arizona, which most of the time, let's be honest, doesn't work out for guys.
Sometimes it definitely cannot. It's hard to make it work out, you know. We took a chance, like you said. Moved out to Arizona. The original gym owner said, hey, I have this state-of-the-art brand new gym. I had this dream of starting a fight team and having a, you know, nice gym and having regular student members, but I don't have any fighters. You know, I got this place, but I don't have any fighters. Do you guys want to move out? So he was actually talking to Crouchy and Alvin Kid Robinson and a few of the other fighters. I just tagged along. I was like, hey, you guys all moving to Phoenix?
Little
like,
did they know.
I want to go too. Yeah. Let me tag along. So I tagged along with them down to Phoenix. And, you know, the original gym owner hooking him up with a per diem, or not per diem, but you know, a little bit of sponsorship. Yeah. I cleaned the mats, you know, mopped the gym, cleaned the toilets, all that fun stuff for the first couple of years.
When you were doing that, did you, in your mind's eye, see yourself holding the belt as long as you did?
I wouldn't say I saw myself holding the belt, but I saw myself being successful, doing whatever it takes to be successful, work my butt off until I was successful. I saw myself doing that.
There was a lot of expectations on him. We all knew he was going to be. Yeah, he wasn't like this, oh my God, Ben made it.
We're
like,
of your wrestling pedigree?
No, just the way he trained. He was so athletic and just better than everyone. Yeah. Like, it wasn't. He didn't come out of like, oh my God, Ben's doing it. No. Like, amongst the fighters, we all knew Ben was going to be pretty special. And then, so you really got into it because of the gi with Crouchy? Is it like with the, because you always see, when I think of you now, I mean, granted, you're this world champion, beat some of the best in the world, but you started really focused on jiu-jitsu like crazy.
Yeah, I think the first year with Crouchy was because of my wrestling background, you know, pretty good in that area, but being comfortable on my back. So for the first year I did jiu-jitsu, I did gi, and I did almost strictly for my back, practicing, learning how to get comfortable on my back and throw up arm locks, throw up triangles, and just the whole, you know, getting used to being on our back as a wrestler where you're not – it's not comfortable for us.
You guys are like turtles. Yes.
Yeah. So like for me, like just immersed myself in that world, like really helped a lot.
And then you became obsessed with it because then you started getting, you were always in a gi, and then I see you're teaching jiu-jitsu, right?
Yeah.
Like at that academy, you started teaching jiu-jitsu, and then your wife's, right?
My wife's a couple-time world champion for purple belt level, pretty high-level practitioner herself. She's really good. She's mean. I'm mad enough to admit she has caught me twice, legitimately.
Legit?
Yeah,
legit. No.
I give it to her. I let her catch me all the time. Like, oh, catch that, whatever, yada, yada. But she caught me legit twice. I was like,
damn.
And she knew it?
Oh, yeah.
Was it awkward, or she's like, all right, babe, I'll see you at home?
Nah, she was cool about it. She was cool about it.
You guys have a child now, right? You have a baby?
Yeah, we have a baby just turned 1 2 weeks ago.
Baby boy or girl?
Baby boy.
Love it, yeah. man.
Already showing muscles?
Already choking people out?
He was kicking and hitting the bags. He'll be at the gym, like, as we're teaching class, as we're practicing. Before he was walking, he was punching the bag and, like, kicking the bag, like, almost falling over, but kicking the bag. It's super adorable.
What ethnicity is your wife?
Mexican.
Mexican.
Yeah.
He's going to be a tough little.
So you got Korean, black, Mexican.
Yep. Well, she's half Mexican, mixture of European. So
yeah, real melting
and
pot.
White,
yeah,
and
real
white.
A real melting
straight pot. Melting pot.
You got white, Korean, black, and Mexican. Yep. That's a pretty damn
the American dream.
Damn. The American dream. Yeah. Straight
That's a
up,
composite man right there.
Yeah. When I think of you, I think of a guy like a pioneer, a guy who always takes risks. Like I talked about you going from Denver to Arizona, which people don't realize, man, that's a big risk because Denver, we were killing it. At the time when you left, it was like the cream de la creme, and he left. Did his own thing. It obviously worked out. And then multi-time world champ in the UFC, WEC, you're this multi-champ. You leave. Phil Davis was one of the guys that left, one of the first guys to leave the UFC empire and go to Bellator, which I was like, and I said, I'm like, you're the Rosa Parks of fighting. Congrats, man. You know? And then.
It's a good analogy.
Yeah. And then you were the first kind of, you know, because Phil's never world champion. Phil never had the notoriety and the celebrity that you did. So when you signed, I was like, uh-oh, we got a kind of a game changer here.
Yeah. I think the moving over, especially coming off a couple of wins, not coming off a loss, is a big deal. The UFC, you know, you lose once, they might cut you. You lose twice, is a, you know, good chance they're going to cut you or whatever.
Yeah.
Going to the end of your contract, but if you can go to the end of your contract on a couple of wins, so I was coming off two big wins.
Big wins.
You know? Yeah, so I think that helped me a lot as far as people paying attention and whatnot.
What about what was it that caused you to leave? Was it the Reebok deal? Was it you wanted more money? Was it?
It was all of it. All of it. You got to do what our fighting career is literally how long can we fight for? You know, 8 years, 7 years.
Yeah. If you're lucky.
10 years. Yeah.
You're a complete
10 years. If I'm really really lucky, maybe 10 years. And so as that, you have to do what's best for your family in the time that you have. You can do, you know, podcasts. You can do radio. You can do acting until you're 60, 70. You know, like, you can do that for a long time. But for us as athletes, our window is so short. You have to take advantage of the time that you have. So for me, I was paying attention to what was best for my family, what was best for me. I wanted to feel some offers. I wanted to be a free agent to feel some offers.
Did you tell that? Did you kind of tell Dana that? I don't want to put you on the spot.
No, I let him know for sure.
And what did he say when you said, I got to make as much money as I can? I've been a champion for you for so long.
He said, hey, we're going to put together a good, you know, a good offer to you, and we'll come back to you. And they came back to me with three separate offers. They came back with an offer before my second to last fight, and I said no. And they came back to me with another offer before my last fight. And then two more offers when I was a free agent they came at me with. And each one got higher and higher and higher, but – you know,
more guys, you kind of set the blueprint because you see more. Donald Cerrone did it now.
Yep.
Roy McDonald did it. Matt Mitrione did it. So you see guys, they're not signing that deal anymore because it used to be they'd shelf you unless you signed that contract. Yeah. But once Ben, of his stature, did that, now he goes like, oh, that's the way. He kind of set the blueprint. Guys started doing that. Yeah. I also feel like in the UFC, you've kind of done everything. You've kind of fought everyone. Like, I don't know what was left for you there. So when you move, I'm like, yeah, it's all new stuff.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess a super fight with Conor McGregor, something like that. But other than that, at 55, I don't know what's for you.
I thought at one point in time, I think right before I left, of the top 10 guys, I'd beaten 7 of the top 10 guys at 155.
Yeah.
Going to 170, test those waters, you know, but like, they weren't real big on me going back and forth, going 155, then up to 70, then back to 155, up then 170. So just having the, like you said, the opportunity for new, interesting matchups, and then to do what I want, to have a kickboxing fight. Bellator said, yeah, cool, we're open to that. Maybe it won't happen, maybe it will, but we are open to that. We are open to talking about that. With the UFC, so many of their things were like, no, we're not talking about that. No, that's not on the table. No, that's not an option. No, that's not an opportunity we're willing to look into at all. It was just no. I was like, huh, well, I want to go somewhere where I have opportunities, where I have options of maybe doing this or maybe doing that. And Bellator was super amazing, super awesome. But yeah, we can talk about that.
They're open to it. Like a lot of guys, like you see, like Rampage Jackson, Mitrione, even Phil, a lot of them came over to Bellator for the entertainment value too, as far as they can do movies, they can do this TV show, it's in the contract, they can do this commentating. Sponsors, obviously, but as far as entertainment goes. So did you, was that any of a, like, did that weigh on your, because you're not really, I wouldn't say you're a guy. Yeah. You don't want to be famous. You want to be able to walk down the street.
Yeah.
You could care less about being in movies, being on TV.
Yeah, I'm not one of those guys who's like a high entertainment guy. I don't want to be in movies. I don't want to do all this sort of stuff. But it is smart of those guys to sign to Bellator for that reason. Bellator is owned by Viacom, a huge company who owns VH1. They own Spike. They own MTV. They own a bunch of stuff, So anytime you can get under an umbrella company like that, there's a lot of different options for you. So for Rampage, a guy like that, what better company would you want to be a part of than that?
True,
than
and, them, and Tito. I think, like, we had Randy Couture on last week. We had Randy Couture, and we're talking about the Fighters Union and all that, the association stuff like that. I think it's good, but I think the best thing for the sport is competition. So I think in order for things to change the way they are now, and more rights for the fighters, more money, more benefits, everything, Bellator just needs to keep getting bigger.
Yep.
That's going to be your best bet to get some change, some competition.
Absolutely. We live in a free market society. That's what we're all about, as America, right? Open competition. So the more competition there is to the UFC, instead of having a monopoly, and this is the way things are, having other options to go here, to go there, it's always good.
The only like knock, obviously, with you going to Bellator is the level of fighters you're going to be fighting. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's some your first fight. That guy was enormous.
Yeah, he's tough.
I've also trained with that guy. And he's so tough.
Yeah,
he's huge. What's his Russian name?
Andre Korshkov.
Korshkov. Yeah. Yes,
big boy.
He's a monster.
He threw me a whooping.
Well, but
he's just a monster. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But The issue's always going to be with you going over there to Bellator is the depth and the guys you're going to be fighting. You know what I'm saying?
That's what it is. It's the depth. They have a really tough top, two, three guys. But then after that, it goes down quite a bit. So as far as Bellator, what they're trying to do is to build up that depth, to have you go from two, three really tough guys, big names, to like three, four guys,
correct,
five, six guys, seven, eight guys. And right now they're doing a great job of building up some of their fighters to have bigger names like Michael Page. Yeah, Michael Venom Page, who's not the belt holder at 170, but perhaps has a bigger name, has a bigger draw.
They built him up.
Has, good skills on the ground, good still standing up, really exciting, fun to watch, real crowd pleaser. So I think that's smart of Bellator to do it like that.
Are you going to stay at 55, go back to 55?
Bellator, the reason why Bellator signed me was for big fights. They signed me for big fights.
So you take whatever.
170, 155,
exactly,
doesn't
do.
Matter.
Right.
Yeah. You should be committed to a weight class.
You watched the UFC this past...
I did not. I wasn't able to.
Okay.
No. I read about it afterwards, obviously. I saw some of the highlights and whatnot online.
I mean, you have a tough fight coming up, though. You know this better than anyone. You have a super tough fight.
The guys who don't have as... Pitbull has a good big name. Patricio Pitbull has a good name. He's tough. Former Bellator champion.
Yeah.
Anytime you fight a former champ, you got to know they've seen everything. They've been through the thick of things. They've been hurt and come back and won. He's been around. And so fighting a former champ, I know he's going to be tough. I know he's going to be good. Sometimes if he didn't have the biggest name, those fights are even tougher because
– it's more pressure on you, man.
Yeah, he doesn't have a big name. Who did he lose to? Oh, he just lost to some guy.
Yeah.
Didn't really know who he was, yada, yada, yada. But he's a tough cat, though.
Is fighting, though, for you, because, like, as far as pressure is concerned, is it just – you're regular. I mean, you were a high-level wrestler, competed a lot. Do you feel the same way when you, like, has it always been a through line, or is fighting a different mindset for you than wrestling was?
No, for me, competition is competition, period.
Right.
Doesn't matter whether we're playing tennis or we're playing pickup basketball, going on to the local aquatic center, to the local Y, play pickup basketball games, some high school kids. They normally... do pretty well against me, youngsters.
I don't know, but
for me, competition is competition. It doesn't matter whether it's fighting, MMA, jiu-jitsu, whatever it is. I want to win. Play Scrabble right now. I'm going to beat your butt in some Scrabble.
So you're competitive across that.
Dude, Ben and I did this thing for the UFC with the Marines. So I think there's five of us. And Ben was like the lead. Like, we'd wake up at 5 in the morning. We had all our boots. We had 80 pounds of gear on, and we had to work as a team. And you could tell, like, out of that group, and there were some studs, but you could tell, like, Ben was different. Like, his mentality, like, we had to run up the mountain, and he was just, like, boom, like, gone.
Well, I told him before he got here, I said, I always marvel at your cardio. I never saw you in the fifth round.
Especially how muscular
you are. I just never saw you get tired. It was the craziest. I never saw you slow down, I should say. I'm sure you were exhausted because fighting is. But at 25 minutes and minute 20, you were. It looked like you were just as fresh. That's what always blew my mind.
Yeah, the old Dan Gable saying, the wrestler in me. Yeah. You gotta be in better shape than the next guy. Cardio is king. So it doesn't matter. Like you can be the most technical, have awesome technique, and be amazing and an awesome boxer and knock everybody out. But as soon as you get tired, you start going down to here.
Wasn't it Vince Lombardi who said fatigue makes cowards of us all?
It's true too. It's true, man.
That exhausts.
You start getting a little bit tired. Like your punches start going a little bit slower. Like, oh man. Yeah. This guy's not getting tired. What am I going to do?
What do you do with that? Are you just a long runner? You train like a boxer? Or?
Just everything. We try to take everything to the next level. Always trying to get better. Always trying to improve. Always trying to grow. Always trying to get better cardio, better muscular endurance. Some guys, they train strictly just cardio, but then their muscular endurance isn't there. Their lungs are there, but their muscular endurance isn't there. Or they train their muscular endurance and their cardio not there. The lungs get tired, vice versa. You got to be able to do both.
Have you changed anything, Ben? Because like when we first started out, that mentality of sparring and toughest guy in the room stuff, and we spar a ton.
Yeah.
And then as you get more knowledge around the game, and you're as veteran as it gets, you've been there with the best in the world. Do you see your camps changing? Like, is Crouch changing things for you as you get older?
I think they change a little bit. You're always whether you're the last year's Super Bowl champions and then going to the next year, you're always trying to fine tune things. You're never settled. You're never set with, okay, this is our routine, this is how we do things, we're done. We're not going to grow from here. We're not going to get better. We're not going to change things. You're always looking, you should be, I feel, always looking to change, to grow, to get better. So my camps, we definitely change things up. We try to adjust here, adjust there, trying to be very aware, very conscious of, oh, last camp, I was a little bit tired going into Saturday, so I'm going to adjust and do this. And now my hard cardio day is not going to be Friday before, a hard sparring day. I'm going to adjust it to a Thursday, or I'm going to adjust it to a Wednesday and give myself 2 days to recover, yada, yada, yada. So I always try to adjust little things here and there.
And you have the same, like you guys have a team in Arizona. Like you're not flying guys in for camp.
No.
You stick with your team.
No, I think one of the best things for me, for myself, for my career is my gym, the MMA lab. Like we have... Truly, we have guys on our team, teammates who I consider brothers and sisters, my godfather to my son, the godmother to my son are on my team. We truly care about each other, help each other. We want each other to live our dreams. They're helping me live my dream. I'm trying to help them live their dreams. And without that kind of support, being a fighter is hard. It's tough. If you train with somebody who doesn't care about you, you're like, F you too then, man. Like,
but it's also, it's the thing with that is jealousy. Like some of the teams I've been on, it wasn't like, we were there to help each other get better, but it was a jealousy thing.
Yes.
It was very strange.
I completely agree. I think at our gym, we guys come into our gym all the time. We have, guys from England come, guys from Miami come, and they stay for like 6 weeks or so, and they do the camp there and they come back. A lot of the guys, they end up relocating to Phoenix, the chain of our gym. Alex Cascaris is one of those guys. Great guy, great fighter, very fundamental, solid fundamentals.
Fundamentals are very important.
The fundamentals.
Fundamentals are very important, guys.
Very important.
Glad you brought that up. Thanks.
But I think without that, like some guys are definitely jealous. This guy's having more success. But I think the guys who fit in our gym, the guys who end up making it and staying long term, like who fit in our gym, are all like good stand up, solid guys who don't have like jealousy problems or don't get mad at somebody else's success. They don't
no egos.
Not show up. Yeah, all the egos at our gym are left at the door. And the guys with the egos, they come down to our gym and then they don't fit and they end up. Leaving after 2 weeks or 3 weeks just because they don't kind of fit in our place.
They don't fit the
when
mold.
When you stop, because you're such a competitive guy and you've trained, it feels like you don't really take a lot of time off. It feels like you're always 2 weeks out. You can always fight anytime.
Yeah,
right?
Anytime. Most of my fights, I'm back in the gym on that Tuesday. Like, we come back on Sunday or whatever. I'm back in the gym by Tuesday or Wednesday. Nothing super intense. Like,
right.
not
you're teaching, though, right, too?
Yeah, teaching, too. I'll do our fight team practice and just, take it nice and easy, not go too hard, but you still practice right away.
So there's no boredom factor. There's no sort of fatigue, general fatigue at... Here comes another day of practice because you're always trying to do something different, always trying to improve. That mindset, is that what keeps you
yeah,
passionate.
I'm always trying to work on other new things too. I'm always trying to, again, like I said, to grow. So like, you know, I'll spend like when I get back, like, oh, I really wanted to work on my gi game, so I'm gonna get back in the gi, start working on the, you know, start working on this series, the koala guard, or start working on this guard, or start working on this. I wanted to play with the Barato Plata a lot. So like after a fight or after whatever, I have something I want to work on. Oh, after this fight, I really want to work on my Muay Thai, you know, plum clinch. So I spend like 3 weeks or 4 weeks or however long just working on that for like, you know, a solid time to invest getting better in that one area.
You also compete in jiu-jitsu though, which is
I do a lot of tournaments,
which is rare for a guy of your caliber to, because you gotta think about it, when you walk into IBJJF whatever match, I don't care if Bushesha walks in, I don't care if Cyborg Abreu walks in, you're the guy they want to choke out.
Yeah.
Because you're the guy everyone knows.
I got a pretty big bullseye on my back no matter where I go. If I go into a gym like in New York City or like wherever I go to work out, there's a bullseye on my back.
100%.
If I go to any tournament.
Everybody wants to be the one.
Yeah. If I go to any tournament, there's a bullseye on my back. And I know that. I'm aware of that. I think it also helps me drive me, helps make me better, helps make
me stay focused.
Yeah. Like I know if I walk into a tournament, every single person there is like, oh yeah. I want to piece of him.
You know what's going on YouTube. Yeah, if they do catch, it's going on YouTube. So I just think what's remarkable to me is there's not too many guys of your caliber that would put themselves on the line and enter a jiu-jitsu competition. Yeah. You know what I'm saying?
I think a lot of guys have a hard time with that, being willing to lose.
It's an ego thing.
Yeah, it is an ego thing. They're scared, like, oh, well, I don't want to lose this one. And then even the sport of jiu-jitsu itself, you can lose off like one advantage, which is not even a point, but a guy's gonna get one advantage and know how to hold you, know how to hold the gi here and push you here, and then he holds you for 6 minutes because he knows he's up by one advantage, and it doesn't matter how he wins, he's gonna say, hey, I beat the former world champion, I beat this guy, I beat that guy. So it is a bit of an ego thing, not willing to go out there and put yourself out there and do tournaments and stuff.
Well, how will you supplement this when you finally retire? Because you've been fighting a long time and you have a lot more fights. Do you have a number of how many fights you have in you, and do you have a plan for what retirement is going to look like?
I don't have a set number of fights. I do know I have a set number of years.
Which are what?
32, 33, 34.
He fights Friday or Saturday?
Friday night.
So if you would have told me a plan of your retirement and how many fights you have left, I'd tell you not to fight Friday night. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, you have a hell of a fight on Friday. Yeah. Like, he has his hands full.
Yeah, sure.
So if you ask the Pitbull what his plans are, it's not to retire. Like, you're not, you know what I'm saying? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, Ben, in a lot of ways, has proven. I don't know that you have much more to prove. You are, for a fan like me, you're the quintessential warrior. You're such a fighter, and you've done everything, and you've fought everybody, and you've beaten everybody, and done it in every way you can think of. I mean, and you were so surprising. Your fights were always so exciting. You'd be there, and we'd be like, what's he going to do? And you'd throw your entire body and elbow the dude from a distance that would take, like, somebody should kick from. Like, what the fuck is he doing? You'd fight dudes who were so much taller, it didn't matter, and you would always figure your way through. So, in a way, you still obviously feel like you have challenges and things to accomplish, but with somebody as intense as you are, who's as competitive as you are, it's going to be interesting to watch how you adjust now to that insane energy that you have for winning. I'm sure you're going to be successful at anything you do, by the way.
Yeah, I'll hopefully have, like, as far as money-making thing, like, I'll have some opportunities to present, you know, that I'll be fine money-wise. Yep. I'm not too worried about that. But as far as, like, competition-wise or just getting my kicks off, like, getting a good sweat. If I wasn't for fighting, I'd be that weird dude in the gym who was like there 7 hours a day.
Just a monster.
Dude, are you still? Why are you still here?
Just a monster in the gym.
I came in at lunch break and you were here, and now it's like 5 and you're
sucking
still
on
here.
What are you doing? Yeah, never leaving the gym.
I would be that dude.
Will you teach anything? Will you be a coach? Will you have a school?
I'll always be involved in wrestling. That's my first love. So like I'll probably coach high school, coach college somewhere, something like that. That's for great. Sure. Always be involved in wrestling in some way, shape, or form. But I'll probably get into like marathons and triathlons and stuff.
That'd be
sick. I always
wanted
to do that.
Yeah, you can run. I've seen it firsthand with 80 pounds of gear. I was like, God damn it. Do you see in other sports, like you see in the NBA, if there's a huge free agent, LeBron or the Curry, you know, they're like, dude, come over here, come play for us. Do you feel like you have to do that for some of these free agents? Like, because there's some big, like, Cerrone's contract's up. Roy McDonald's contract's up.
Roy McDonald, Rick Story.
Lorenzo Larkin.
Yep.
Larkin, yeah. There's a bunch of guys who are just like,
mutiny!
I don't think I'm going to recruit, say, come to my team, because we're not really, it's not a team sport. It's not a team, so to speak.
I'm saying recruit, come to my organization to bring eyeballs.
Yeah. I would just say I give them my honest opinion. Is all. I give my honest opinion, how I'm treated, how much money I'm paid, how well they're taking care of me, yada, yada, yada. The opportunities that Spike has brought to me. I said no to a bunch of them already, but sure. Spike said, hey, do you want to do this or do you want to do this? Like red carpet stuff all the time. So if you like red carpet stuff, you know, they have, you know, how many different.
It's Viacom.
Exactly.
So just so everyone knows, Viacom's way bigger than anything the UFC signed with.
Yeah.
As far as money, tentacles, it's way bigger.
So, I just give my honest opinion, say, you know, what they've done for me so far, what they've given me options of doing, opportunities and whatnot. And then, obviously, they got to make what decisions, you know, best for themselves. Think of their family, think of longevity of their career, all that sort of stuff. They got to think about that.
Donald Cerrone, as an example, couldn't look better. I just feel like he's fighting at the better than he's ever fought in his life.
I wasn't able to watch the Rick Story fight, but I saw some highlights.
He looked great.
I saw that four piece he hit. They landed
straight
all
Mortal
four.
Kombat four piece combo.
All four landed.
Yeah, you're talking the guy who beat Donald three times.
I know.
Rick's my boy too. I love Rick Story. He trained in our gym for three of his fights. Rick Story trained in our gym. He was undefeated.
Tough guy, man. Then he took a lot of time off, right? He got injured.
I think it was like a neck problem.
He's a sturdy son of a bitch.
Yeah.
I mean, tough. But to watch Donald make piecework of him, all due respect to Rick, but Donald's so good. He's at a point where it just looks like he's improvising up there. Yeah. He's just there. Here we go.
And you got the WC boys have such a history, man, with Cerrone, yourself.
Yeah.
Pettis fights this weekend. Yep. You want to talk about a guy who needs to win, man.
Oh,
brother.
He's on three losses in a row now?
Three or four. And it's like he's not even ranked anymore. Oh. You know, he's fighting and he has a tough fight.
Who's he fighting? Who's he up? You have a fact checker.
Who's he fighting up? Hold on, you come to me.
What's your take on
Oliveira,
that,
that's right. Oliveira.
Yes. Charles Oliveira.
Super tough fight. Yeah. Especially style-wise. Yeah. Like, it's a tough fight, man.
Don't let him on your back.
Yeah, man. Yeah, Oliveira's a black belt on the ground. Yeah. Obviously, stand up, he's a beast.
Yeah.
Like I root for Pettis, man.
Yeah.
I love that guy. It's just
I hope he doesn't get to four losses in a row.
They'll cut him for sure, especially how much he's getting paid.
Yeah.
God,
four
crazy.
In a row.
Four in a row.
Have to.
You can't have four in a row.
Yeah.
Unless you're
What is your take on USADA PEDs? How they're cracking down, guys are getting caught.
For me personally, I think that if you do take any performance-enhancing drugs, knowing that they are banned substances and whatnot, then you are mentally weak. If you think you need an extra edge that is banned and no one else is allowed to do it. So I think it makes you mentally weak. And if you have that little bit of mental weakness, and I will find it and I will break you.
Yeah,
I will break you if I know you have a crack in your armor.
Yeah.
But is it... for me, the bigger thing is that it puts a stain on our sport if it's not legitimate. If people feel like it's not legitimate, like for baseball, for how many years ago when everyone was talking about McGuire and Barry Bonds and this and that, how much of a stain did it put on baseball? How many people were talking about, baseball records, asterisks and this and that? It put a stain on the sport of baseball.
It was also, for me, so eye-opening because I'm not an athlete like you. I didn't know what steroids can actually do. So if you look at Barry Bonds, you look at Sammy Sosa when they came into the league.
Yes.
And then you see Jason Giambi, and you see what those, literally the 40 pounds of muscle they put on.
Yeah.
The 40 pounds. Mm-hmm. Even the 50 pounds of muscle. For us, it was like, I was like, wait a minute. Whoa, what the fuck is going on here?
When your body changes from your 15 to 22, natural. You grow, you put on weight, you put on size, understandable, you know?
Yeah.
When your body grows from when you're 25 to 32 and you gain 40 pounds of legitimate muscle.
Like get leaner.
Get leaner and put on muscle. Yeah. It takes time to do all, to
when
change your body.
When your bat speed gets faster, gets quicker in your 30s, it probably doesn't make a lot of sense.
Yeah.
But what's interesting about what you said is the psychology there. If you've been relying on PEDs, and you could see it with a lot of fighters, and I won't name names, but their bodies were so... they were so tight, and when they stopped, you were like,
it's
your body looks very different,
evident.
Sir.
Yes, it's
it looks very different,
very,
and you're losing
pretty
a lot.
Drastic, pretty drastic.
But what's drastic about it also is it must be the mental idea is like, now I don't have that thing that made me whole.
Yeah.
And now I'm naked.
But Bellator doesn't use USADA.
Bellator does not use USADA, no. No. Mm. They just do the athletic, does their testing pre-fight and after fight.
Yeah. Which is, I mean, it's still good. It's just that USADA, I mean, guys are tested positive for, like, eating cupcakes. Like, it's literally, they're gonna, you know, it's
crazy.
It's
a,
well,
crazy
there's the, it. We were just talking about this morning, what substance was it? The meat in China and the meat in Mexico.
Yes, the beef.
The cows, the beef, yes. The cows are fed this hormones to make them grow faster.
It says that they also are, they were also fed, cows in this country as well are fed primarily estrogen. They have an estrogen pump, which makes them heavier. They retain water.
Hey, but B, that's not what they're flagging for. What he's talking about, guys are actually flagging for. Like, they're testing positive from eating this meat. So the NFL, NBA told any of their players and UFC, they all gave notice. If you're in Mexico or where was the other?
China.
Yeah. Don't eat beef.
Wow.
Don't eat the meat. No, it's legit. Yeah, it's not like
that. It's an actual steroid. Not just
no, it's like actual. And guys are testing positive for it.
Where can I get that beef?
Yeah, right? Overeem's like, yeah, that's what I took.
Yeah, that's
what
I took.
No, mine was horse meat. Yeah, the horse is eating the same thing.
Yeah.
Can't wait to go on steroids.
Let's do some. We got a ton of fan questions for you, but we'll only do like five or six, Ben. And cool. I know you're cutting weight, man, and busy dude, so we got you, brother. What do you got, Ev?
All right, go straight to some fan questions here. All right, first one that we got for you. Why do you fight with a toothpick in your mouth?
Seriously.
Such a good question. I forgot about that.
We had 100 of those.
First of all, how the fuck do you do it and not swallow that
toothpick? But why?
It's just a bad habit. It's just a bad habit.
Do you have one in right now?
I don't have one in right now. I don't have lunch yet. Normally, I'll have lunch, I'll have dinner, or you know, whatever, messing around. I have a toothpick in, and then I forget about it. I go train, and I just have it in. I'll have one, you know, going to go have lunch, and then I'll go to the venue, the fight venue afterwards. I just happen to have it in. I don't take it out. I forget about it, and then I'm walking up, and I'm going, I still have the toothpick in. Like, no biggie.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I do it for practice all the time. Yes. You know, my training partners, like I have for practice for boxing, we'll be boxing. I'll poke it out and I'll forget about it. I'll play with it. I'll poke it out. I'll poke it back in. And you can tell the guys who are like newer at the gym, because they look at me like, I was like, oh yeah, I forgot. I'm sorry. Yeah. Don't worry about it. It's
okay. How do you not have holes in your face?
I was going to say, is that a psychological thing?
It gets wet.
Now? Is it like a good luck thing? Or?
No.
It's almost a comfort thing, right? It's just a habit.
Just a habit, yeah. The one time, actually, rolling with one of the first times I rolled with John Crouch, him and I were rolling, he caught me in a rear naked choke. But it didn't finish rear naked. He went to the neck crank instead. And while he was finishing the neck crank, he actually finished the neck crank, but I ended up getting the toothpick stuck in my freaking cheek. And I tapped to that.
Yeah.
He said, was the neck crank tight? I didn't go to the rear naked. I adjusted. I went for the neck crank and said, was that what you felt? Felt the neck crank? I pulled out the toothpick. It was all bloody. I was like, nah, I got my toothpick stuck in my cheekbone there.
Yeah. That's How long have you been doing that for? A while.
My mom said I've been doing it since I was really young.
It's just your thing.
Yeah. My mom said I saw it from my dad. He always had a toothpick in. So I got the bad habit from him.
That's cool.
It scares the crap out of me now. Now I see my 7-year-old son, 7 years from now, 6 years from now, I see him running around freaking our backyard with a toothpick in his mouth, falling down and 100%. Tripping and swallowing a toothpick. So that scares the crap out of me.
Yeah, but you turned out all right.
Yeah, I turned out okay, yeah. But now I have I make sure I don't. I used to sleep with a toothpick in. My wife got real mad and you know,
used to sleep with it.
Yeah, again, I would always have it in, but now I don't do a toothpick at home anymore, ever. I don't
really
because I want my
toothpick free zone.
I want my son to see it.
Did you ever do the flavored ones, like the cinnamon ones? I used to love those.
You guys gotta check out Danison toothpicks, Worthy and Folsom toothpicks, great stuff. But they have some really interesting good flavors on their toothpicks.
Really?
Yeah. Good stuff.
I'm all about it. I want one right now. I'm going to start just carrying one all the time.
Some wood what in else my you mouth. Got, sharp wood in my mouth.
All right, next one. What were some of the unexpected changes that you experienced when transitioning to Bellator?
Some of the unexpected changes transitioning to Bellator, I would have to say just the entire behind the scenes process. As Brendan knows, like the UFC process, we know it, we've been through it. We get there on this day, we're supposed to do this, we have media on this day. Coming over to Bellator, like... I don't know a lot of the guys' names. I'm horrible with names.
You're the new kid in school.
Yeah.
You don't know the process, the teachers.
Don't know the names. Don't know everybody. So I have to learn everybody's names and figure out what, you know, what jobs they do. Oh, they do this, they do that, and where I need to be at this day, this time. It's a very just different process, like the very different schedule they have.
Just new.
This day you do media. Just new, just different to me.
Did you get any backlash that you didn't expect? Like, did you get a lot of haters when you left? Or did people kind of support you?
Mostly everybody was pretty supportive.
All I saw was support.
Because of, like, the Reebok deal and the way the UFC's been the past couple of years and matching some fighters.
People
up
were happy for you.
Yeah, they, people, pretty positive experience on my part moving over to Bellator.
I thought it'd be the one thing positive. Maybe get a little bit of hate from the UFC fanboys, something like that. But
no, they've been pretty good.
That's good, man. Good, yeah. What else you got, Em?
No reason to hate.
That's a good segue. Speaking of dealing with haters, hey Ben, why do you argue with so many people over politics on Facebook? I like hearing your opinions, but it must be frustrating.
You feed the trolls?
I feed the trolls a little bit. The trolls are hilarious and like
depends.
Yeah, it depends. Yeah,
depends what you're talking about.
So some can be truly offensive, but you know I think politics is one thing, but I think we do need ability to discuss it.
Yeah, civility. In this world. Civility.
Yes. If you can't talk important. About something,
critical thinking,
if
have
you can't
an opinion.
Even talk about yes. it. How are you going to solve anything?
Yes.
Exactly.
If you can't even talk about it
without someone getting defensive or being mean, yeah. it's crazy.
Well, because what happens with politics is people break it into teams.
Yeah.
And it creates a whole bunch of emotions. The minute somebody is a conservative or Republican or a liberal, and the minute you start coming up with a different point of view, you're threatening what they consider to be sacred yeah. because
you're also not open-minded
is what's giving yeah. them their lifestyle.
I was at an event this weekend and we're all sitting around having dinner watching the fights, and there's something about Trump, and this guy goes, oh, don't get her started on Trump, don't get her started, and don't even ask, she gets so upset. Yeah. Like,
but
what's wrong with you?
You should be allowed to talk about
and
it.
I'm like, you're for Trump or against it? And she goes, for him, but don't get me started. Like, okay, I mean, look, you can tell me your point.
Over, yeah. Discussion over, nobody's creating a bridge. It's exactly what happens.
That?
Yeah, it's exactly what happened. That's the biggest
you
problem.
You must be
it's
a thrill to hang out
to
with.
Yeah. You've got to figure out, I look at the world as there are problems that need solving. And both sides probably have some value that can contribute to solving those problems.
Amen to that.
And that's so, important. That. You know, they did a study on Trump supporters, and there's this idea that all Trump supporters have a lot of racism and stuff like that. But the problem was that this reporter, was a liberal reporter from, I think it's the Washington Post, went and spent 6 weeks with a number of them. He said, there are 13 million from the primary vote. It's way less about racism. A lot of them are just economically afraid. Mm. That he taps into a fear
yeah.
about where the economy is going, where their livelihood is going.
That's what most politicians do. They yes. tap into what people that's are afraid right. of, and they use it to get them to
classic.
So you'll get on Facebook and argue with these fans?
Oh, well, I'll just see an interesting video.
You give your point.
Post. I give my point of view. I say, hey, this is an interesting video here. It talks about this or talks about that. And then, of course, you have the trolls. Who want you to acknowledge their existence.
You'll post.
The first thing they do is they insult you.
Yeah.
The first
well, you'll post, but as a fighter, though, it's different. Like, you'll post something about Trump or Hillary or something like that. Like, yeah, that's why you lost that fight.
Yeah.
Hey, man, I'm talking about yeah. pizza right now.
Yeah.
Yeah, whenever I see you get too cocky, I watch this fight. I'm like, all right, man. Yeah. That's cool, bro.
God bless you. Yeah, God bless you.
Fantastic, man.
I think that all of us, when you reduce a candidate or even their supporters on either side down to sound bites and down to one-dimensional
yeah.
Entities.
The same thing as reducing a fighter's whole career down to, two highlights.
His last fight.
Right.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Right. But he has a whole long career of
body of work.
Wins. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. But then you reduce it down to just this, just that. You know?
And
but like you said, though, I think the important thing is there's a problem. And pretty much we all want to live the American dream. Everyone in America wants to be happy. They all want the same. We all want the same
better
thing.
Life
we,
for their kids.
We want
better future.
Exactly. We want the same end results.
Yeah.
We kind of have an argument or disagreement on the best ways to go about there.
Yeah.
But both sides have valuable, good input on how to get there.
Exactly.
If you would just listen.
Work together.
Just talk about
yes.
it.
Yes. Talk
but
about
as soon
it.
As you refuse to talk about it, don't talk about it. I don't want to talk about it. Don't bring it up.
Then
don't
they insult each other.
It's
you're an idiot.
And yeah. dude, I
well, you're ugly, huh?
Yeah. I've had this with people who I'm sitting there and I'm older than you guys. I'll be with a bunch of successful people that are really educated. And the minute you bring up an idea, a political idea, maybe a different way of looking at it, everybody gets tight and everybody stops talking.
Yeah,
it's very weird.
It's unbelievable. Yeah. And so what happens is none of the ideas, the important ideas, don't move.
Yeah.
There are a lot of great ideas that are stuck in books. They're stuck in quiet academics. They're stuck in regular people. And because they don't feel safe, they don't have a venue to get those ideas out, the problems stay the same. When you talk about gun control, do we all agree we don't want mass shooters killing a bunch of people in a movie theater?
Everybody raises their hand.
Yeah,
now, I own guns. That's fine. But I'm open to the idea that maybe there's a side on the other side that has maybe some valuable yes. points of view that yeah. we can implicate. Yeah. God what, damn it. Why else? Are we not running the world?
At least be willing to hear it.
Yeah.
Yeah. At least be open to it. Exactly. At least be open to other ideas exactly. and suggestions.
Exactly.
What else you got, Ev?
All right. There was a rumor about Benson joining the military reserves. Is this still true? And why the reserves are not
put him right in the special forces immediately.
The rumor is true. I wanted to retire when I was 32 because I talked to a few recruiters and there's a age cap for when you can join the military. Well, I didn't realize, my dumb butt. I didn't do my due diligence. Didn't look up any further. But there's a age cap for every different branch. So for the Marines or for the Army or for the Navy, and whether it's active duty or not active duty. So I'm already too old to join. But
really?
So I have to fill out a bunch of waivers. I have to do like a 500-word essay. I have to do a bunch of, like, there's waivers for everything. But I have to do like 5 or 6 different waivers. And I'm going through the process right now of actually joining the
Army or Marines?
You want to be the Marines.
And you want to be a reserve, not active?
Yeah, probably reserve just because, again, I have a full-time
son.
Job.
You also have a son.
I have a family. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, I'm not 19 joining the Marines. No, you know? Yeah. I have a family. But I do feel a strong desire, a strong need to serve this country, to serve our country. I think one of the biggest things that we do not do in this society nowadays is give back to our country the way that we should. You know, everyone talks about it. They'll post pictures about it. They'll do this about it. But actually backing it up, doing something about it, not just posting a picture, not changing your profile picture or whatever.
For sure. What is the age limit?
For the Marines is like 28.
Can't have old ass soldiers.
Yeah, yeah.
I get it, but you're the exception. Can we get an exemption?
Yeah.
Can we get an exemption?
Yeah.
Hey, Ben Henderson.
I'm in pretty good shape.
Let's go ahead and put him on there.
He'll carry all the gear. Nah, sorry, man.
I can run pretty far. Yeah. I can, you know.
Sorry, man. 28 or bust.
I'm pretty smart. If you have me learn something, I have 2 college degrees. I can probably learn it pretty quickly.
What did you study in college?
I double major in criminal justice and sociology.
Wow. That's cool.
So I was like, yeah, I think I should. Should be good. I think I'll fit in. I can listen.
No, exactly.
I can listen pretty well.
Yeah.
So but the exemption would be the waivers. I have to finish filling out or not. So.
Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah.
That's cool. What else you got, Ev?
What is your dream matchup? It could be a past or present fighter, and you know, any organization.
Conor McGregor.
No. Sorry. No. But since you're in Bellator, let's stick with Bellator. I would love to see you versus Chandler.
Yeah.
That's a barn burner.
Yeah.
You and Michael Chandler?
Chandler has some awesome power in his hands, a great wrestler, so like perhaps wrestling would negate each other, and we'd be standing up. And
that's the fight.
He's going to throw down. I'm going to throw down.
That's the fight,
we're
going to
see, you know, where the chips may fall.
Now, does it get you nervous to talk about a fight like that, the possibility? Do you start planning in your head right away?
He's beat some of the best in the world.
I know.
Not really.
Kind of just.
No. Yeah. But as far as the question goes, I'm not really – I don't know. I guess the Terry Toughnuts or, you know, Billy Badass type of guy where I want to fight this guy or fight that guy or want to test myself against this guy. I don't want to fight anybody. I'll fight whoever they put in front of me. I'll fight whoever signs the contract. I'll fight whoever, anybody, 170, 155, doesn't matter who it is.
But do I want to fight?
I don't want to fight BJ in his prime. I don't want to fight, you know, Matt Hughes. I don't want to fight this guy. I don't want to fight any of those guys. I don't want to fight anybody. Yeah. But I will fight whoever.
That's interesting. So you don't want to – the idea of wanting to fight somebody in their prime just sounds like a lot of pain.
Kind of a waste of time.
Yeah.
I mean, why would you put your effort into that?
Is there anybody stylistically that's fighting right now that you would be the most worried about?
Him and Chandler are very similar.
Yeah, Chandler are pretty close. He throws pretty hard. He throws some heavy, heavy leather. He puts everything behind
his punches.
He
also beat Eddie Alvarez, who's the champ of the UFC right now. Like, there's.
But as far as stylistic, be more aware of. I guess the guys who are a little bit more out there, loosey-goosey with their techniques, maybe like a Michael Venom Page, throw some unorthodox stuff.
He just doesn't have your wrestling, though.
Yeah.
And he's built like a beanpole.
And he hasn't fought any wrestlers at all.
Nothing.
For a reason.
He's so fun to watch, though.
Yeah, fun to watch.
He's the guy who dented.
He's the guy that does this.
Dented the.
Yeah, threw the knee at Cyborg.
Yeah. Broke his forehead.
Broke his face.
Yeah.
That was the craziest shit I've ever seen.
He's out for a while.
Yeah.
Cyborg
that was nuts.
Let's do 2 more, Ev.
Fucking forehead.
How do you describe your mindset to win fights?
My mindset to win fights, I would have to say it's all about preparation. It's all about hard work in preparation. For me, I value nothing else on this planet more. I value at utmost is just hard work, putting in the hard work. I don't care what it is. You could be a cook or a line cook or a chef or a reporter or whoever. I value hard work. So for me, putting in the hard work is why I how I look to going into a fight. If I did the hard work, I don't have no worries. I always use like the analogy of because everybody has experienced this. Most of us have experienced this in high school where you have a test. And did you do the hard work? Did you prepare for the test? Going into a test, if you're ready for it, if you prepared for it, you know, you're not worried. Like, oh, no, yeah.
That is the best.
I
can't wait to take the test.
Yeah, I can give this test to myself.
Yeah.
Backwards, forwards, yep. In and out, no problem. But then also, we've all had those tests where we didn't study for it. Like, oh, man, I didn't study for this one. I'm not ready for that one. Yeah. So then you have your anxiety. Then you're nervous. Then you're a little bit more
But you got to be smart nervous. With your work, too, right? It's got to be smart hard work.
Oh, for sure.
Because hard work can just be a grind. Like, you see a lot of people that are grinders.
Yeah.
And they stay super busy, but they're working, their energy is
placed. Well, it's quality work.
Yeah. Well, people always say, oh, yeah, you can work hard or work smart. I'll work smart. Like, I want to work smart and hard. How about that?
I'm going to double up. That's why you're world champion, sir.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to do both.
Multiple times.
Yeah. So my mindset going into fights is how I prepared for it, how I got ready for it, knowing I did every extra sprint, knowing that I did all the workouts. I didn't skip any. I didn't do this. I didn't do that. My mindset going into fights is if I did that hard work, if I'm fully prepared, I'm good to go.
Boom. Mm. Last one, Ev.
All right, last one. Everyone talks about the level of competition between the UFC and Bellator. What is your opinion?
Level of competition in Bellator and the UFC, I say at the upper echelon of Bellator, the top two guys, top three guys in Bellator, same as the top two guys, top three guys in the UFC. After the top two, three guys in Bellator, it might go down quite a bit more than it would in the UFC. UFC has more depth. But you know,
I think it depends on division, though, Ben. Let's be real here. It depends on division.
Absolutely. It depends on division, too. Absolutely depends on division.
Because, granted, Michael Chandler beat Eddie Alvarez, who's the UFC champ right now.
Yep.
But heavyweights... Mm-mm.
Yeah,
it ain't happening.
Mm-mm. Yeah, mm-mm. Not even close. Mm-mm. But
depends. Like, and that's where Bellator just needs to build the depth.
Yes,
but some of their guys, 100%. Like, look at Brooks, won his first fight, beat a tough winner already, and kind of dealt Ross Pearson. Yeah. He's built like a tank too.
Yeah. He did a great job. Had a great performance. So I think, like, you know, again, the top two, three guys, and depending on the weight class, are fine. I was undefeated at 170 in the UFC. First one over at Bellator, 170, took a L on that one, you know.
Yeah.
So I think the top two, three guys are there for Bellator.
I agree. Yeah. That's it, Ev?
Yes, sir.
Booyah. Ben, we know you're cutting weight, brother. You got a huge fight. It's Friday night. Is that correct?
Friday night.
Honda Center, Spike TV, and it's a big one, man. Whenever you fight, brother, you know I got your back. I know you're a busy dude, so I appreciate you coming in, man.
Of course.
Next time we're in Arizona, you got to come to the show. We've done how many shows there? Four shows there?
I think so.
If you hate laughing and sold-out shows, don't come.
I'll be out there in December stand-up. You come out.
Yeah, I'll set
you up.
I'll hold you to that.
I want you in the front goddamn row.
Make sure you watch Ben Henderson this Friday night. Put on one hell of a performance, everybody. Ben Henderson.
Henderson.
Thank you, guys.